We are on the record. This is the videotaped deposition of Archbishop John Nienstedt, taken on April 2nd, 2014. Time now is approximately 9:05 a.m. Deposition is being taken in the matter of Doe 1 versus the Archdiocese of Minneapolis and St. Paul et al. In the state of Minnesota District Court, County of Ramsey, 2nd Judicial District. This is case number 62-CB-13-4075. Deposition is taking place in St. Paul, Minnesota. My name is Dean Hibben. I'm the videographer representing Affiliated Video. Will counsel please identify themselves for the record?
For the plaintiff, Jeff Anderson.
For the plaintiff, Mike Finnegan.
For the plaintiff, Sarah Odegaard.
For the plaintiff, Ellen Lindstrom.
Dan Hawes for the Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis.
Tom Weiser for the Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis.
Thomas Braun on behalf of the Diocese of Winona.
Joseph Kippers on behalf of the Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis.
And would the court reporter please swear in the witness?
Raise your right hand, please. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give relative to the cause now under consideration shall be the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do. Archbishop, would you please state your full name for the record and spell your last?
John Clayton Nienstedt, Jr., N-I-E-N-S-T-E-D-T.
You've given depositions before, so you understand the protocol here today, do you not?
I think so.
Okay. And it's correct to state that you were appointed and eventually installed as a coadjutor in the Archdiocese of St. Paul, Minneapolis in the year 2006?
2007.
2007. What would have been the date of the installation?
It would have been June 29th, 2007. It wasn't an installation per se. It's just when you become a coadjutor, you're just received.
And then you were appointed to be the Archbishop as of what date?
May 2nd, 2008.
During your tenure as Archbishop, it is correct to state that you have made a number of public statements concerning the fact that the representation that there are no offending priests in ministry, have you not?
I have done that, yes.
When did you first begin doing that as Archbishop?
I don't recall.
How many times would you estimate you have represented to the public and to the people that there are no offending priests in ministry in the Archdiocese of St. Paul, Minneapolis?
I can't recall exactly, but I don't think that they have been many.
You have made such representations to the media, have you not?
I don't believe so.
You've made representations to the parishioners, have you not, through bulletins and otherwise?
Yes, I have.
You have included such representations in materials demonstrated prepared by the Archdiocese and distributed to parishioners and the public concerning priests and ministries who are safe?
The priests are safe, or
yes.
the environments are safe?
The environment's safe.
Yeah.
Do you continue to claim that the environment, the Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis, is safe for the children?
I do.
I'm going to show you what we've marked. At any time since your installation, have you received any information from any source that causes you to want to change any of the statements you have made about the safety of children in this archdiocese?
Well, just in the last month, I did discover that there was a priest who had offended, who retired, but continued periodically to celebrate Mass on weekends. And I was not aware of his presence, and I was not aware that he was publicly in ministry. And as soon as I realized it, I had his faculties removed.
And who is that?
I believe it's Father Levan.
And any other time, other than in the last month, that causes you to believe that the statements that you had made earlier about the safety of the children and the absence of offenders in the Archdiocese ministry to be corrected?
Could you restate the question, please?
Have you received any other information that tells you that the statements you made about the safety of the children in the Archdiocese were not true?
No.
That's it? Levan?
Levan, yes.
And that was last month. How did you get that information?
It was in the process of doing our file review.
Okay. Who was doing that review?
Kinsale.
Spell that.
Kinsale.
And once you received the information from Kinsale concerning Levan, what correction, if any, did you make about the statements you had made to the public and the community of faith?
I don't believe that I did.
Do you think one is needed?
He's out of ministry now, so I don't see the point of making that announcement, no.
It had been known by the Archdiocese that Levan had been accused credibly of abusing at least two girls, and that was reflected in the files back is over a decade ago, correct?
I don't know that for a fact, no.
When you came on as Archbishop, did you ever make any effort from the time of your installation and to the discovery of the Levan material by Kinsale to see actually if the statements you were making to the public about the safety of the children were true?
I met with my staff, and they affirmed for me the fact that there was no one in ministry who had credibly abused any children.
When did you first meet with your staff to make such a determination that the environment was safe?
Shortly after my reception into the Archdiocese as coadjutor.
What staff did you meet with to determine the safety of the environment and whether or not there were priests in ministry who had offended?
I met with my delegate for safe environments, and I met with my civil and canonical chancellors.
And so the delegate for safe environments was then Kevin McDonough?
He was indeed.
Appointed by you to be just that title, right?
I did, yes. He had been previously appointed by Archbishop Flynn.
And was it his job, at least as you understood it, his appointment to be to make sure that the environment was safe, and he was the point guy for handling that?
That's correct.
Okay. And that first meeting then was with McDonough and with the chancellors, both Jennifer Hesselberger. No, she wasn't there then.
She wasn't there at that
who
time.
Who were the chancellors?
Sister Dominica. I can't think of her last name, but Sister Dominica. And Mr. Andy Eisenzimmer.
And how long was that meeting, sir?
To the best of my recollection, it was approximately 2 hours, I believe. It was a long meeting.
And was that at the chancery in your office?
It was at the chancery in one of our meeting rooms, yes.
And in preparation for that meeting, did you order or request that they review any or all materials held by the Archdiocese concerning priests who may have been accused, credibly or otherwise?
I asked, at the time of the meeting, I asked them to give me all that they knew concerning the safe environments of the Archdiocese.
And did anybody put or record by memo or recording the contents of that meeting?
I don't believe so.
So it was all verbal?
It was verbal, yes.
And at that meeting, were you presented with any written materials?
I was not, no.
Did you know, you knew there had been a list compiled under the child for the Charter for Protection of Children, that a list of credibly accused offenders, correct?
I was aware of that. I'm not sure I was aware of that at that time, but I was aware shortly after my arrival.
Well, you were a bishop in New Ulm when the Charter for Protection of Children was established in 2002.
Correct.
And you attended those meetings where promises were made to the public.
Correct.
Across this nation that we're going to have a zero tolerance policy, correct?
Correct.
And you were part of one of the bishops that made such a representation to the people in the U.S. about zero tolerance, correct?
Correct.
So you knew at that time the bishops then commissioned John Jay to do a study to determine, based on information given them, various lists of credibly accused of offenders.
I don't recall exactly when that list was asked for. My recollection was it was in 2004, but I'm not sure about that.
That sounds correct. In any case, you knew in 2004 or thereabouts that the bishops had compiled lists of offenders, credibly accused.
I did, yes.
Did you ask that such a list for the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis be presented to you at this first meeting concerning safe environment in this archdiocese?
I did not.
Why not?
It didn't occur to me.
So, tell me then, who conducted the meeting?
Father McDonough conducted the meeting.
And tell us what Father McDonough told you, Archbishop, responsive to your request about the safe or lack of safe environment in the Archdiocese of St. Paul, Minneapolis, and what priests had been accused and what priests were or were not in ministry.
Well, he described for me the POMS program that we have, which is our monitoring system for priests who have abused, and explained to me how that worked, and explained the situation of what those priests, that those priests were not engaged in ministry.
And okay, I'm going to stop you there. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you said the POMS program?
Yes. POMS is...
Spell that.
P-O-M-E-S, I believe.
Okay.
P-O-M-S, I believe, yeah. P-O-M-S.
And, you said that was a monitoring program, correct?
Correct.
And did you ask him the names of the priests that were being monitored under the POMS program as McDonough recited this to you?
I had asked for the meeting, and he was chairing the meeting, and he began to tell me the individuals who were under the POMS program.
Who were those individuals?
I can't recall the names right now.
Why didn't you write it down?
It didn't occur to me at the time to do so.
At the time, didn't it seem like one of the most important things you needed to do as Archbishop, knowing the crisis of in America of Catholic clergy abusing kids, to know who in this archdiocese had been accused and who were currently being monitored?
Well, I had asked for the meeting precisely so that I would know what the situation was and that I could assure myself and assure my publics that the environments were safe.
But Archbishop, you can't remember who that was that you were told today.
There were several names that were given to me, and I was assured that their situations were being monitored and that they were not likely to reoffend. And that was the primary purpose of the meeting.
And you say several names. How many?
I don't recall exactly. There were several.
Well, what does several mean? Is that more than 10 or less than 10?
Object. You don't have to guess, Archbishop. If you know, you can answer, and if you don't...
I really don't know.
How many... How were you told these priests were being monitored?
I don't understand the question.
What were you told about how these priests who had been accused were actually being monitored so that they would not offend or reoffend?
Well, I was told that we have a promoter of these safe environments who meets regularly with the individuals. I was told that they were undergoing regular therapy, that they were in spiritual direction, and that they had to sign a contract to the effect of how they would be monitored.
Who is the promoter of safe environment?
Right now it's John Selvig.
Who was it then?
I can't recall the name.
When you say then, you're referring to the time of the meeting?
Yes.
I can't recall his name.
Okay. And when you say that they were to sign an agreement, would that be an agreement not to reoffend?
It was a signed statement indicating what we expected of them. I don't believe that it said in those categories, although it was understood, that they weren't to offend again.
And did you have any personal knowledge or experience with offenders, clergy or non-clergy, who are accused and who have offended, that there is a high recidivism rate, and when they do reoffend, they often lie and deny about it so that you can't rely upon them? Were you aware of that?
I believe I was, yes.
Well, then what made you think then, if you did, that simply monitoring them and asking if they're reoffending would work?
I asked Father McDonough at that meeting to tell me what we were doing in terms of making sure that these men were being monitored and that they had a program that we were holding them to.
Did you, as a result of that meeting, disclose to anybody in the public or any of the parishioners any of the names that you were given by your team about those priests who were being monitored and who had offended?
I did not personally know.
Did anybody under your direction, working with and under or for you in the Archdiocese?
I believe I was told that Father McDonough carried out those disclosures.
What disclosures did he make?
He did not... As I recall, he did not tell me exactly who he made the disclosures to, but generally speaking, they were people in the parish.
Well,
they served.
Didn't you ask? Didn't you say, Father McDonough, we have a number of priests who you, the exact number you can't remember today, who are under monitoring, who we know have offended in the past. Didn't you go back and say, tell me exactly what you're going to do and when you're going to do it to make the public know?
I asked for that meeting so that I would understand more clearly how the environments that we have in our parishes and our schools would be safe for children. And that's our primary objective.
Archbishop, isn't it correct that you really didn't want the public and the people to know who was being monitored at that time?
Well, it's objection. That's argumentative, counsel.
You can ask
a question.
I don't believe that's true, no.
Well, then, can you tell me exactly what offenders that had been or under monitoring were then actually disclosed to the public as a result of that meeting?
I can't answer that, no.
Can you tell me when any of those offenders who were disclosed to you at that meeting were ever disclosed to the public?
I know that they have been. I can't tell you the exact dates or the times that they have been disclosed, but they have been disclosed.
Can you tell me any the name of any offender or the time at which it was done where the Archdiocese, under your direction, either Kevin McDonough or anybody else, made an actual disclosure and it wasn't made by somebody, some third party?
Well, yes.
Such as media or ourselves?
This past October, I believe, when we made our first disclosures.
So is it correct to say then that from your first meeting, a staff meeting shortly after your installation that you described, between that and October 13th of this last year, October of this last year, you can't identify today any disclosures made of any of these accused offenders who were being monitored to the public?
Well, in
objection, that misstates testimony.
In that meeting that I had, Father McDonough told me how we approach the situation and what kind of disclosures he made. He didn't tell me exactly which disclosures and what day the disclosures were made on a particular individual.
Well, I'm asking you what disclosures were made to the public. I appreciate you have this information in your inner circle of the chancellors and the delegate, Father McDonough, who I think was then Vicar General, wasn't he also?
No, at the time I was coadjutor, yes.
Yeah. And in any case, we'll call them your inner circle, but beyond your inner circle, I'm asking you to tell me, if you can, if there were any disclosures made of any of these offenders identified to you who were under monitoring to the public until October of 2013.
Father McDonough informed me that as part of our procedures, we would disclose to certain people in parishes where priests had served.
And how was it determined who would be told in those parishes?
My recollection is, as I recollect now, it was the pastor and the trustees of the parish.
What about the parishioners and the public? Didn't they have a right to know who was being monitored and who had been accused?
I find it difficult to answer that question.
Don't you think they have a right to know who has abused children and who is being monitored, in addition to the pastor and the trustees, so they can protect their kids and know who might pose a risk of harm to their children?
Are you speaking of priests that are still in the ministry or serving?
Speaking of the priests that are being monitored.
Well, other than those who are serving?
The question stands. You identified a number of priests who are being monitored, right?
Correct.
They're all priests who are in ministry, correct?
No, they were out of ministry.
They're out of ministry. They're still priests.
Correct.
They were still active as priests.
No, they wouldn't be. If they were out of ministry, they wouldn't be active as priests.
And so they were in various capacities in the community, right? But not in ministry. Is that what you're saying?
I don't understand what you mean by capacities.
Well, they were... are you saying then, Archbishop, that the monitoring program only covered priests that were not in parishes?
No, I'm not saying that.
Okay. Let's break it down then. How many of those priests that you were told were under monitoring were actually in parishes then?
Well, you have to understand that the monitoring system, the POMS program, included priests who had abused children and priests who had other behavioral difficulties. For example, if they had been arrested for a DWA, drunk while driving while drunk, or other kinds of abnormal, I would say, behaviors. So that was all put together. So it wasn't just those who had abused children.
How many then that were accused of having abused children were disclosed to you that were under monitoring?
I don't recall that number.
And how many of that number were still in ministry?
My recollection is that the only the one that I cited before was in ministry, and he was retired. The others were out of ministry.
And is that Ken Levan?
Yes.
And that was, and when was the first public disclosure of Ken Levan having been accused as an offender and that he had been under monitoring?
I don't recall that. Sorry.
Isn't it reasonable, Archbishop, that if you, as the Archbishop and your team, saw fit to put them under monitoring, as you've described in this program, isn't it reasonable that the public and the parishioners in the community of faith be advised that there is a reason to put a priest under monitoring and that you have this program so they can know there is an issue?
Objection calls for a legal conclusion. Go ahead if you can answer.
Could you rephrase the question for me, please?
Why didn't you tell the people that you had a number of priests under monitoring?
I believe that we felt that we could monitor the situation without making a total disclosure to the people.
You still feel that way?
No, I do not.
What made you realize that that was a bad decision?
Well, objection, that's argumentative.
What made you realize it was a bad choice?
Same objection, argumentative.
I think over my tenure as being Archbishop, I have had new insights into how we should proceed with these situations.
And so when did you realize that?
I can't give you an exact date, but it's been probably over the last 2 years I've come to appreciate that.
So in the last 2 years, once having realized it, what did you do about it to correct it?
Well, we,
in terms of public disclosure,
we made sure that if there was an incident that happened, that the trustees of the parish would be informed of that. And then, of course, last October, we made a full disclosure.
Are you sure it wasn't December that you made that disclosure?
I don't recall the exact date.
When you say full disclosure, what do you mean by that then?
Of the 43 persons that we've put on our website.
Archbishop, you have resisted very vigorously through your council and publicly the dissemination of the list of accused offenders, incredibly accused offenders, have you not?
Objection. It's, again, a legal conclusion. You can answer to the extent you know, Archbishop.
That is to the public.
Could you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
You have continuously, until ordered by the court, resisted making a public disclosure of the names of the credibly accused offenders on the list compiled by the Archdiocese, have you not?
Objection, that misstates the facts and the evidence.
My understanding is that we voluntarily disclosed those names, the first names on the John Jay list. We voluntarily went to the court asking them to unseal those names because there had been such a notoriety, I would say, about that list of John Jay. And as we discovered, and as we've made public since then, that there were names on that John Jay list that should not have been there, who had not abused children.
Archbishop, you're aware that it was our office that has persisted in trying to get those lists disclosed by you and your office for years, including in the John Doe 76C case, correct? You're aware of that?
I'm aware of that, yes.
And you're also aware, are you not, that you released that list only after we brought another motion before Judge Vandenhorst, and it was very evident and imminent that it was going to be required, correct?
Objection, misstates facts and evidence. Go ahead.
I don't recall that, no.
So you're saying to us today, under oath, that you made the conscious choice to voluntarily release that list?
We did, yes.
When you did?
Yes.
And you made that choice for what reason?
Well, in an attempt to be transparent with our publics, with the Catholics in the pew, because the media had made such a big deal out of the John Jay list.
It was public pressure, wasn't it?
I wouldn't say so. I think it was conversion on my part to see that this was something we should do.
Was it legal pressure by us?
No, sir.
No influence, huh?
I wouldn't say that, no. Okay. There were multiple influences.
Okay. If it wasn't us, and it wasn't the media putting in pressure, you say you had conversion. What gave you this conversion then, if it wasn't public pressure by us or the media?
Discussion with my team.
Who?
It would be my communications director, my chancellor for civil affairs, my chancellor for canonical affairs, my auxiliary bishops, my moderator of the Curia.
And who urged you to keep it quiet on that team up until that time?
Object to the form.
I can't recall anyone specifically doing that.
Before you actually had this conversion, after meeting with the team that you described, had any urged you to make it public so that the public could know who was on it?
I don't recall.
From 2008 until 2013, you made the choice to keep that list secret, did you not?
It already had been kept secret, and I didn't see any reason to disclose.
After that first meeting you've described, in which you were informed that priests were placed on monitoring and no memo was made of that or notes taken by you and or recording made of that meeting. Why not? Why not? Why not record that? Why not put it in a memo? Why not get that list at that time?
Objection. Can you break it down and ask a question instead of six?
Why not make a recording of the whole thing? Didn't it seem important enough to get down, to get recorded, to get done?
It was important to me. I asked for the meeting with Father McDonough so that I could have an idea of where we were in terms of our safe environments.
Were you concerned, Archbishop, that we shouldn't make some recording of this meeting about these decisions to keep this secret or not? Because if you did, it might be subject to some discovery by us or others who were in litigation with you and the Archdiocese?
Well, that didn't occur to me at the time.
Did it ever occur to you at any time, or were you told that some of these things, conversations, shouldn't be put in writing because they could be discovered by us in litigation and known to the public?
I believe that Father McDonough once said that to me.
When?
But it was outside of that context. I can't recall exactly the date.
How long ago?
I don't have any recollection of that.
What were you discussing?
I don't recall.
Who were you discussing?
That I don't recall either.
Anybody else give you that guidance?
No, sir.
Anybody else present at the McDonough meeting when he said that to you?
It wasn't at that meeting. I didn't want to imply that. I don't recall the circumstances in which he had said that.
Yeah, I'm just talking about when McDonough told you that. Was anybody else present?
I don't believe so, no.
Okay. You must have been discussing something very sensitive at that time, but you just don't recall today what it was and who been involved?
I don't, sir. I'm sorry.
You followed his advice, didn't you?
In terms of?
Not putting certain things into writing.
Yes.
How many different times do you think you chose not to put certain things into writing concerning scandalous material such as sexual abuse by minors?
It wouldn't have been very many.
Well, very many. Does that mean more than a dozen or less?
My understanding today is that would have been less.
Okay. Tell me the times that you remember having conversations where you made the conscious choice not to put it into writing because you were concerned, as McDonough had advised you, that it may be subject to discovery and litigation, and you didn't want it to be recorded.
I can't recall the number of times. I'm sorry.
Tell me the contents of any of those conversations and with whom they were had.
Again, I would just be guessing. I would be speculating.
And because it was not recorded on any journal, any diary, or the contents of any of those discussions, there would be no way to test or determine today how many times you actually did have such a conversation, correct?
That is correct.
Do you keep a journal?
I do not.
Do you have any memory today of having any of those meetings or the contents of any of those meetings where you made the conscious choice not to record it because it could be discovered or discoverable in litigation and it pertained to sexual abuse of minors by priests?
I do not.
Do you have the names of any of the priests in mind that you're thinking today? I do remember discussing ex-priest and making the conscious decision that we can't put that in writing because if we do, Anderson and his team will discover it. It could be public.
First, that assumes facts, not in evidence. I don't think he's ever testified to that. Archbishop, don't guess or don't just assume that that's what happened just because the question's asked that way.
I would be guessing.
Okay. So my question to you is, do you have any memory of any the contents of any conversation concerning any offender today that falls into that category of no notes or records made?
I do not know.
Okay. Did you instruct anyone else to not document conversations such as that for the same reasons at any time?
I don't believe I did, no.
Okay. So that would be just you and McDonough that that particular practice would apply to, correct?
Objection. That's not what he stated, that it was a practice, as you've implied, counsel. Don't misstate the record.
Give me a legal objection.
The objection is don't put facts into the record that are not accurate. You are doing that.
Take it off the time. Give me a legal objection. What's the legal objection?
You're misstating facts and absolutely trying to change and taint your record for your media. And that's not what is appropriate, counsel, and you know it.
That is not a legal objection. Archbishop, the question is, anybody else besides yourself and Father McDonough made a party to such a practice of not recording sensitive meetings such as that?
Not to my knowledge.
Same objections.
Archbishop, did you review any materials in preparation for your deposition today?
I did.
What?
I reviewed the Charter for the Protection of Children and Young People. I reviewed a summary of the Adamson case. And I reviewed the case of Father Montero.
Anything else?
No, sir.
Okay. When you say you reviewed a summary of the Adamson case, what was that that you looked at?
It was a summary of his particular file that we had.
Prepared by whom?
By Mr. Kippers.
And when was it prepared? As was it for your review and this deposition?
I beg your pardon?
When was it prepared?
I believe it was in the last 2 to 3 weeks.
And for this deposition to help you?
Yes.
And was the same kind of thing prepared for Montero that you reviewed?
No, it wasn't as extensive.
But was that also prepared by Mr. Kippers for you in preparation for this deposition?
Correct.
Anything else that you reviewed?
No, sir. I did review the names of the 43 priests that are on our website.
That's it? In terms of review?
Correct.
Did you learn anything in your review of the Montero summary prepared for you in this deposition, in preparation for this deposition, that you had not known before about Montero and his history?
I did. I learned that the charges against him had been dropped before he left the country.
Did you not know that until you reviewed the summary?
That happened before I became Archbishop.
Had Montero ever been on your radar as a priest who had been accused of offending and had left the country in the Archdiocese?
Yes, I was aware of that.
How did you become aware of that?
I believe at the time that at the time that he had left, and a letter was sent from Bishop Pates to the bishop in Mexico explaining to him the situation that we had experienced here.
Did you yourself ever request or demand that any of your subordinates and those in the inner circle, the chancellors or the vicar generals or auxiliary bishops, ever retrieve any files of those who had been accused so that you could make an independent decision to review those files yourself?
Could you repeat the question?
Have you ever reviewed any of the files, except for what you just described involving Adamson and Montero prepared for you? Have you yourself ever reviewed any of the priest's files personally so that you can be satisfied that you are making the right decisions concerning that priest?
Well,
I object to the form. It's compounded.
We've had, since December, a complete review of the files by an outside company called Kinsale.
Okay. And but that's something you've delegated, though, isn't it, to somebody else?
Something that we hired a group outside company for, yes.
Now I'm asking you personally, have you ever said, I want to review the file of Father X and have that file produced to you in its entirety so you could make a fully informed decision about what to do or not to do? Have you personally ever done that?
I don't recall that I have.
And until recently, you had delegated that responsibility then to whom?
To the delegate for safe environments.
And that would have been McDonough?
It was Father McDonough until about a year ago when Father Dan Griffith, another priest of the Archdiocese, took that position over.
And did you make the decision to remove McDonough because of disclosures about how he had handled this publicly? And there was both criticism and scrutiny of that?
No, I realized that he had multiple responsibilities. He'd been in the job for 17 years. And I felt it was time that we needed a change.
Have you at any time warned, penalized, or reprimanded McDonough for the way he handled his job as the delegate for safe environment under your charge?
I don't believe so.
Do you fault him for any of the decisions he made or recommendations to you now?
I've always believed that Father McDonough had the best intentions. He certainly shared with me the priority we had of maintaining safe environments in our parishes, our schools, and our other programs.
My question goes to actions, not intentions. Have you ever reprimanded or criticized or faulted him for any of his actions taken concerning any of these priests who have offended and have been accused of offending?
I don't recall having done so.
As you reflect today and look back at the history now before you, do you fault him for any of the decisions that he made as your delegate and or as Vicar General in the Archdiocese concerning the safety of children?
The only thing that comes to my mind is the fact that I learned subsequent to subsequent to the fact that when Father Wehmeyer was arrested for drunk driving, that was not shared with the trustees. And there was some reason that he had for not doing that. I disagreed with him in that decision. That's the only one I can think of.
Any other decisions concerning sexual abuse of minors and Father McDonough's actions pertaining to that you either fault or now look back upon as deficient in the protection of children?
Object to the form.
Could you rephrase that question, please?
Any other actions taken by Kevin McDonough as your delegate for Safe Environment or as Vicar General that you look back on now and say, he blew it when it comes to the protection of the children and the recommendation he made to me?
Object to the form. It's argumentative. Go ahead.
I don't believe so, no.
So you think he did a good job about that, huh?
I believe he did.
You think you're doing a good job?
I believe I am, yes.
Have you yourself, when you reflect on what has happened to date and all that has been revealed to you to this date and time, have you yourself made any mistakes in failing to protect children? And provide the safe environment to this community that you promised when you took the job?
The only mistake that I know for sure I made was not removing the faculties from Father Levan, but I didn't know that was happening at the time. Once I learned it, I acted.
Any others? Is that it?
That's it.
Let's talk about Father Levan then for a moment. You continue to maintain publicly and as a part of the Charter for the Protection of Children adopted in 2002 to believe that this archdiocese has a zero tolerance policy when it comes to sexual abuse. Is that correct?
We have tried to maintain that as our standard, yes.
And you say you have tried to maintain that as your standard. Have you maintained that as your standard?
I believe we have. I think the record shows that in the last 20 years we have had two incidents. Now those are too many, but two incidents in which child had been abused by priests who were in ministry at the time.
And what two priests are you referring to, Archbishop?
Father Francis Montero and Father Wehmeyer.
And how was then the zero tolerance policy as represented to the people violated as it pertains to Father Freddie Montero.
Objection, that misstates facts. He didn't say that it was.
Didn't you say that it was?
Did I say what?
Didn't you say that the zero tolerance policy was not adhered to when it came to Montero?
No, I didn't say that. We immediately we removed him from ministry and turned the case over to the police. So I believe that we maintained the zero policy that we had.
Did you ever review the Montero file itself?
No.
Were you aware that Montero was living with Father Kevin McDonough?
I believe I did know that.
Were you aware that Father McDonough had some responsibilities for supervision over him because Montero was an extern priest from Ecuador?
Well, my understanding was that he lived in the rectory at St. Peter Claver.
And that's where Father McDonough was assigned as pastor.
Correct.
And he's assigned there so McDonough could keep an eye on him. Were you aware of that?
I was not aware of that.
Were you aware that Montero...
That was before my time.
Were you aware that Montero was allowed to leave this archdiocese and return to Ecuador before the police could complete an adequate investigation?
Objection. It misstates the facts and the evidence.
My understanding of the facts is that the charges against him were dropped before he left the country.
Do you have any information that the police investigation had not been completed?
No, I don't.
Okay. Are you aware that as soon as Montero was allowed to leave the archdiocese and return to his home diocese in Ecuador, he was placed in active ministry?
We removed his faculties when the accusation arose. We never gave him back faculties, and he returned home to his own home diocese.
And did you tell the bishop of his home diocese that his faculties had been removed because an accusation of childhood sexual abuse had been made against him?
Yes, I believe Bishop Pates was the one that wrote to the bishop about that.
And what bishop did Bishop Pates write to?
To the bishop of the diocese. I can't recall the exact diocese in Ecuador.
And was that were you aware that Father Montero was immediately returned to active ministry in Ecuador?
I would only be speculating to say that I did. I don't know for sure.
I called Father Montero shortly after we learned and brought suit concerning that case, that he was in Ecuador, and talked with him. And he was then in active ministry. And did you know that we had a conversation with him?
I did not.
Did you see anything in the Montero file that you reviewed that we had such a conversation?
I did not specifically review the Montero file. I had a summary from my civil chancellor.
Father Montero did not indicate that any restrictions on his faculties had been placed and he was in active ministry. Does that concern you, that he's now in Ecuador in active ministry?
Well, I believe that's why Bishop Pates wrote the letter to the bishop. We were concerned about that.
But I'm talking about today, about the kids in Ecuador having reviewed what Mr. Keppers gave you in preparation for this deposition, and having reviewed that, are you now concerned that maybe something more should be done about Montero being in Ecuador, given the benefit of what you now know that you didn't before?
Objection. It's argumentative. Go ahead.
I would agree to that, yes.
Maybe we should do something about that. I was able to call him and talk to him. Maybe this would be a great opportunity for you to directly contact the bishop in Ecuador and say, Bishop, we do have concerns based on what Mr. Kepper has told me and the information we have about the safety of the children in Ecuador, about Freddie Montero. Maybe you should give him a full disclosure of what you know here and about what happened. Do you think that's a good idea?
Objection. That has nothing to do with this case, counsel. It's argumentative. It's a speech. It's compound. Asked dozens of questions within it. It assumes facts, not in evidence. It's your facts. To ask a question, and he can answer.
Speaking of objection,
ask a good question. That's one question.
Are you willing to do that, Archbishop?
Willing to do what?
Contact the bishop in Ecuador.
Well, as I indicated, as I indicated before, he's already been contacted. That happened before I became Archbishop. I would be willing to contact him again and to share my concerns with him, yes.
I would appreciate that. I think it's very important that you do that. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Have you at any time reprimanded, punished, demoted, or taken any action against any priest for their mishandling of childhood sexual abuse, while Archbishop?
Could you repeat the question again? You had several verbs there.
Have you at any time reprimanded, punished, demoted, or taken any disciplinary action against any priest or official of the Archdiocese for their mishandling of child sexual abuse allegations?
I don't believe so, no.
Do you believe you should have?
No.
Do you believe there are any priests in the Archdiocese or officials in the Archdiocese that have mishandled childhood sexual abuse?
At what point in time?
Allegations since your installation.
No, I don't believe so.
Father Michael Stevens, what do you know about him?
I don't.
Are you aware that in the mid-1980s he pled guilty to criminal sexual conduct with a minor?
I'm not to know.
Are you aware that in 2002 he was publicly removed from ministry?
I'm not aware of that.
At any time, are you aware that the parishioners or the public were ever informed that Father Michael Stevens posed a risk of harm to the children in the Archdiocese?
That was all before my time.
Are you aware that Father Michael Stevens is on monitoring?
Excuse me?
Are you aware that Father Michael Stevens is on monitoring
now? In the POMS program, yes.
And the only ones that know that are now us and those in your inner circle, correct?
Object to the form. I don't know inner circle.
Well, the inner circle would be the chancellors, the auxiliary bishops, and the vicar generals, and your officials. And the monitors.
I don't know that as fact.
Are you aware that Father Michael Stevens, while on monitoring, still performs IT work for the Archdiocese and for various parishes?
My understanding is that he had in the past, but no longer does, perform that service.
And he is still a priest, correct?
I believe that's correct.
And when then did he stop doing the IT work in parishes and for the Archdiocese while a priest?
It was some time ago, but I can't tell you the exact date.
What prompted the revocation or termination of his IT work?
I don't have that answer.
Who does?
I would presume Father McDonough would know. I think that that happened under his watch.
His watch as promoter, but your watch as Archbishop, correct?
I don't have those dates.
Does it concern you to hear and learn that you had and have a priest by the name of Michael Stevens who was on the monitoring plan? And by the way, that monitoring plan, did you inherit that from your predecessor, or did you start that?
I inherited it from my predecessor. Okay.
Does it concern you that you have Michael Stevens on such a monitoring plan and that he is still a priest and allowed to go into parishes and do IT work, knowing that he had been accused and not under monitoring?
That would be a cause for concern.
Isn't it a conscious choice being made by Father McDonough to take the risk to let that guy out there as a priest even work in the parishes?
Objection, that's argumentative and misstates facts and evidence.
I would have to talk to Father McDonough about that.
Do you think it deserves some attention?
I would be willing to talk to Father McDonough about that.
Thank you. Now, there is some indication that Deacon Rourke is the monitor of Stevens. Are you aware of that?
Deacon O'Rourke was the Palms person. That's the name I couldn't remember before.
Okay.
But Mr. John Selvig is now the monitor.
Is it O'Rourke or Rourke? I've seen it both ways.
Yeah, I can't tell you.
Okay. I've got it as Rourke.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. Are you aware, Archbishop, that Father McDonough communicated to the monitor, Rourke, concerning Stevens, that Stevens was in 4 to 5 parishes and the pastors in those doing IT work and a priest? The pastors had not been informed of the fact that Stevens had been accused of sexual molestation.
On what date are you referring to?
I'm just asking if you're aware of that.
I was not aware of that.
Are you aware that Jennifer Hasselberger, your former chancellor for canonical affairs, raised concerns with Father Laird in 2011 about Stephen's status as a priest in the parishes doing this IT work and that he had had a criminal conviction?
I was not aware of that.
Is it your testimony that Father Laird never discussed that topic with you?
To the best of my recollection, he did not.
Is it your testimony that Jennifer Hasselberger never brought to your attention concerns that Stevens would not be working in the parishes, being able to do IT work if he had been a layperson because he wouldn't gotten by a record check?
I am not aware that Jennifer ever brought that to my attention.
Did you remove Father Laird as a vicar general?
I did not.
Did he resign?
He did.
Why?
To the best of my recollection, he had disagreed with me at the time that I had made Father Waymire pastor of Blessed Sacrament and St. Thomas the Apostle parishes. And he felt that when the NPR story came out on the 28th of September, that reflected poorly on himself, and he felt that he had to resign because of it.
Did you ask him to resign?
I did not.
Do you hold him responsible for the failures that led to his resignation, or do you hold yourself?
I don't
Objection,
know
it assumes facts, not in evidence. What failures? No one's discussed failures.
I don't know what failures you'd be talking about.
Well, you referred to the NPR story. What was the NPR story that caused the ultimate resignation?
Well, the objection, that's not what he stated either, counsel. Try to ask questions that are questions.
Just a minute.
And not put
don't instruct me. Give me a legal
I'm
objection.
I'm instructing you, counsel, because you've continued to misstate evidence and try to create your own evidence by putting facts into a question that don't exist. That's
just
an inaccurate statement.
I'll rephrase. Did the NPR story trigger Laird's resignation?
I believe it did.
Okay. What was it that caused, in the NPR story, that triggered it?
Well, we didn't talk about that specifically, so you'd have to talk to him about that. But my recollection is that he said, he used the expression, "I'm being painted with the same brush you are." And he said, "I need to resign to maintain my integrity."
I'm sorry, there was pounding. I didn't hear what you said he said. Could you repeat that?
He used the expression, he said, the media is painting us with the same brush, and for my own integrity, I need to resign. I believe that's what he said.
Did you feel bad for Laird and consider him to have been a victim?
I don't know that I considered him a victim, but I felt badly that he felt he had to resign, yes.
There was an audio recording made of a meeting you had with priests and reported by NPR where I think to paraphrase, you described Father Laird as having been a victim in this whole thing. Did you use those terms to your fellow priests in the meeting?
I don't recall. I remember the event, and I spoke positively about Father Laird and the contributions he had made to the Archdiocese. I don't remember the exact words I used.
Did you listen to the NPR recording of your own words about Father Laird?
I did not.
Did you hear about that?
I heard that was surreptitiously and secretly that recording was made, but I didn't listen to it.
Did you discipline anybody or investigate anybody for having made such a recording?
I did not.
Do you know who did?
No, I don't.
Do you care?
Who did what? Who did the
recording?
There were only probably 9 people, 10 people in the room. But if I were to guess, it would just be a guess as to who it was.
Okay, don't need you guess. Archbishop, I'd like to ask you about Father Gilbert Gustafson. His current status in the Archdiocese is what?
I believe that he is retired. He's in our monitoring program, and he's living on his own.
You're aware that he had been convicted of criminal sexual conduct?
I was, yes.
When did you first become aware of that?
I think during the last 6 months.
Were you aware that he had been at some point in time, either prior to or after your installation, working at the Archdiocese offices in the tribunal?
I was not aware of that, no.
Were you aware that a protest had been done prior to your installation at the Chancery about Gustafson's presence as a priest at the Archdiocese?
I was not aware of that.
Are you aware that Father Gustafson has worked as a consultant at Cristo Rey Jesuit High School?
I learned about that just recently. I wasn't aware of it at the time.
And when did you learn that?
I believe I learned that in the as a result of the Conseil file review.
Were you aware that Father Gustafson, after a lawsuit was brought against him by Ann Bunsey, who became quite public about it, was placed on disability and is now receiving disability payments?
I'm not aware of that.
Are you aware that there is an insurance company in the Archdiocese that insures the Archdiocese and priests in it?
Yes, I'm aware.
That qualifies somebody such as Gil Gustafson for disability?
I am aware that there is such a program.
What's the name of that company?
I can't recall it at the moment.
Is that administered effectively by your office?
It would
at
be
least under the control?
It would be done through our finance office.
And are you aware that Gil Gustafson, as we speak here today, is receiving disability payments every month for the diagnosis of pedophilia?
I was not aware of that. No.
Do you know what pedophilia is?
I do.
Do you think that's appropriate, Archbishop, for him to be getting disability payments for having the diagnosis and having been established as being a compulsive sexual offender that qualifies him for that diagnosis?
I'm not aware of those facts.
That's a legal conclusion. No foundation here, but also a legal conclusion, and I don't think that the Archbishop is qualified to evaluate who qualifies under insurance policies for disability counsel.
I'm not aware of those facts.
Okay. When you say you know what pedophilia is, let's make sure we're talking about the same thing.
Okay.
Under the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual used by mental health practitioners, and for purposes of establishing disability and the like and other reasons, pedophilia is defined as a compulsive sexual interest in prepubescent adolescents. Now, keeping that diagnosis in mind and now being informed that he is getting through this program disability payments for that diagnosis. Does that concern you?
Same objections, and Archbishop, I don't know if you know how to answer how he qualifies under an insurance policy contract, you can answer. If you don't, you can advise that you don't understand or know.
I don't understand, and I have not had those facts. I'd have to look into the facts to see where the truth lies.
Well, does it concern you, having heard what you just did, that he was working at Crystal Ray and allowed to?
That would have been a concern, yes.
Why haven't you gone back to the files pertaining to Gil Gustafson and others like him? Stevens and Levan and those that we've discussed at least so far, and made sure that you're abiding by the promise of zero tolerance and the safety of the children in this archdiocese.
There's no evidence, counsel. You have implied that that hasn't, that there's been some violation of zero tolerance, and there's no evidence of that. So your statements, again, if they're...
Do you have an objection? State a legal objection.
I do, counsel.
Don't give me a speech.
No, here's my concern, counsel. You are trying to make sound bites for yourself and for a media by inserting facts that do not exist. And so when you say that and imply that there's some violation, when there is not, that is unfair and it's inappropriate. So if you want to ask the Archbishop questions about which he knows and can answer, he'll do his best. But don't imply and don't create your facts for a media soundbite.
Why do you think you don't know that one of your priests, Gil Gustafson, is getting payments for a diagnosis of pedophilia while he works at Crystal Ray?
Well, I would have to look into the facts. You're telling me facts that may or may not be true, and I would have to look into that. We just had this Kinsale group, as I mentioned, go through 800 files, and they're still in the process of doing that. I suspect that their findings are going to be enlightening for us, and we will follow up on whatever they have come up with.
Do you consider it a violation of the promises you've made to the people and the zero tolerance policy to have allowed Levan to have worked in parish?
I didn't know he was working in parishes. He was retired, and so he shouldn't have been working in the parish.
You learned he was, though, didn't you?
Just recently I've learned.
So it was a violation, wasn't it?
We took him out of ministry as soon as we learned.
You say we learned. How?
I learned, yeah, I'm okay. Sorry.
That means other people learned. He couldn't have been in there without other people having known, right? Under people under your control?
I don't know that as a fact.
You want to take a break? We can take a break. Is it a good time to take a break?
Sure, if you like.
Okay.
Thanks.
We're going off the record at 10:31 a.m. This is video number 2 in the deposition of Archbishop John Nienstedt, taken on April 2nd, 2014. Time now is 10:47 a.m.
Archbishop, going back to the monitoring program for a moment, today, are there currently any priests on the monitoring program pertaining to accusations of sexual abuse of minors?
Are there those on the POMS program?
Yes.
Yes, there would be.
How many?
Well, the living members who are on our website.
You're talking about the 36 that are living? That are still priests?
36, that would be, yes.
Okay. Did you say 6 or 36?
36, I think. Okay. That's my recollection, anyhow.
So is it your testimony that if they're still a priest and still alive, but on the list of credibly accused, as reported on the website, which is 36 in number, they are on the POMS monitoring program?
My understanding is yes, although they have been taken out of ministry and they've had their faculties removed, so they can't function as priests any longer.
Are there any that are on monitoring that are not on that list currently?
Yes, there would be, because the monitoring program includes those who have abused children, but also includes others who have not abused children, but who have maybe had a drinking problem or a problem with an adult, some form of bad behavior.
Are there any that are on monitoring pertaining to sexual misconduct?
Yes, there would be.
Has that been made public and known to any of the parishioners or the public?
If there's an accusation of sexual misconduct, we ask the individual priest to step aside from ministry, and that becomes known to the public, yes.
Is there an instance where you can point to where the priest has stepped aside, resigned from ministry, and the reason for that has been disclosed as allegations of sexual misconduct?
You lost me there for a minute. Could you repeat that?
Are there any instances where you've disclosed that the reason they're being stepping aside or stepping down is because of allegations of sexual misconduct?
Yes, there have been cases of that.
In what case?
I'm thinking of Father Huberty.
Anybody else?
No one comes to mind. That's the case that comes to mind is the most recent.
Any cases that you know of where sexual misconduct was involved and it wasn't disclosed to the public and the parishioners as to why the priest was taking a leave or a sabbatical or resigning?
Yeah, to the best of my ability, I can't think of a case.
What about Shelley?
Well,
The parishioners weren't told that he had been in possession of child pornography.
That's true.
And they weren't told, and the public was never even alerted until October of this last year when we made that public.
You've made your record that's wrong, and there's no evidence of child pornography, as you said. The claim has been pornography. And so let's be clear, when you try to assert your facts, they're different maybe than the real facts. Ask the proper questions.
I was going to make that intervention and say that it was submitted to the St. Paul Police Department twice, and twice they said they didn't find child pornography.
Was everything in possession of the Archdiocese files turned over to the police for their investigation at the time they were doing that?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Was the report done by Satter and Associates turned over to the police?
Yes, that was part of the file.
Was the report done by Johnson, the forensic report?
I believe that was part of the file. We turned everything over in those three files, everything that we had.
Have you reviewed the Shelley file personally?
Personally, I've read an awful lot about that. The files themselves I have not gone through.
Okay. We'll go through that a little later. Have you told the parishioners and the public that the names of all the priests in the POMS program?
Well, there would be, as you stated before, the number that have been removed from ministry. And that would be known to the public. I'm not sure that those, and so my answer would be that everyone who has an allegation of child sexual abuse would be known to the public.
I'm asking broader than that. I'm talking about everybody in the program. Have the parishioners and the public been informed of all the priests who are in the POMS program for whatever reason?
I'm pretty sure they have been, but I can't say for sure. But my impression is that they have been made known. They have been disclosed.
I get the impression that a lot of the responsibility for the safety of the parishioners and the public is delegated by you to folks. Is that a fair characterization or not?
Well, I'm typically a hands-on person, but I have to delegate responsibilities, yes.
You have been described by various peoples at various times, priests included, both in New Ulm and in the Archdiocese as a micromanager. In terms of your management style, would you say that's a fair characterization?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, you would say a hands-on manager is a fair characterization, because I think those are your words, right?
Right, correct.
Do you feel you have taken a hands-on approach to sexual abuse of priests? Excuse me, sexual abuse of minors by priests in this archdiocese?
Yes, I believe so.
What action, besides the POMS program that you've talked about, demonstrates your hands-on approach to sexual abuse by priests in this archdiocese?
Well, the whole Virtus program that we have that assures us that people are receiving background checks, they're given training in terms of what to look for, signs. We've had clergy study days in which we've discussed all these related issues.
Anything else?
That doesn't come to mind.
I'd like to ask you about Joseph Gallatin. Is he on any list?
He would be on the POMS program.
And besides those, and that would be for sexual misconduct pertaining to minors, correct?
There was an allegation. That allegation is being investigated now, and so I can't say definitively that it was.
When you say being investigated, is that by the police?
Yes.
Do you have a practice that if an allegation is being investigated by the police, that you do not take action as to that priest because you believe that to do so would suggest the priest's guilt?
No, that's not correct. We
just okay. Moment.
Well, let him, he can answer his question,
counsel. That's not correct.
Well, he can answer and tell you why. So you can finish, Archbishop.
Okay.
You can ask why.
He can finish his question and answer to the question.
Is your answer no?
Could you repeat the question, please? I'm a little confused right now.
Do you have a practice that if a priest is being investigated by the police for child sexual abuse, that you do not take any public action as to that priest because you believe to do so would suggest the guilt of the priest?
No, sir.
Have you ever expressed that view to any of those who occupy positions as officials in the archdiocese, such as your current chancellors, or your former chancellors, or your auxiliary bishops or vicar generals?
No, because we let the police do their own work, and then we would have our own investigation. We have two boards set up, one that deals with precisely the charter issues, and then we have a ministerial standards board that we've set up for everything else. And those would be the areas that would ask for and do the investigation.
Did you ever express that view or practice or the desire to employ such a practice to Jennifer Hesselberger?
I'm sorry, what view or practice?
The view that you would take no action concerning a priest while there's a police investigation.
Well, we do take the action of removing him from ministry.
But do you say why?
It depends on the case. Okay.
And do you also choose not to tell the people in the pews and the parishes and the public because you don't want the suggestion of guilt of the priest to have been made by that disclosure?
Well, by the very fact that the priest is removed from public ministry is a signal to the people that something's wrong. But we haven't done our investigation.
Well, Father John Shelley went on sabbatical, and he told everybody he went on sabbatical, right?
He did, I believe, yes.
Yeah, that was with your permission, that he told everybody that, right?
That's true. He was on sabbatical.
But the fact of the matter was that it had been discovered that he had been in possession of possible child pornography.
Well, objection, that misstates the facts and evidence as well.
Is that correct?
No, it's not correct. He was in possession of pornography, but he was never accused of a crime.
Is it your belief that for him to be guilty of the crime of sexual abuse or possession of child pornography, he has to be charged with it by the law enforcement authority?
Our standard practice is that when we receive an allegation or we have reason to believe that there has been a violation, we turn that matter over to the police immediately, which is what we did in his case.
And then if the police do not charge, is it then your belief and practice that the priest is effectively exonerated?
We would do our own investigation after that.
And you said that Shelley was turned over to the police. Mm-hmm. When was that?
When the incident was prior to my time, so I can't give you a date, but it was on, my understanding, two occasions that that was given, the files were given to the police.
Right. In 2004, you're aware that your predecessor, Archbishop Flynn, and his subordinates became aware of his possession of materials that were borderline child pornography, at least, correct?
Objection. You're again misstating facts.
I don't know when that happened. I don't have a recollection of that. I do know that on two occasions that a computer was taken to the police. But on two occasions it was also said that it wasn't child pornography.
Did you ever, while the Archbishop here, tell anyone to report Shelley to the police?
Did I? The incident happened prior to my being Archbishop.
I know, but he continued as a priest while you were Archbishop.
That's true.
And he continues as a priest to this day, although he is on sabbatical, correct?
He's on a leave of absence at this present moment.
And when he took that leave, he told the people that he was going on sabbatical, did he not?
Yes, he did.
And a party was held.
I don't know that.
So my question to you is, did you personally or order anyone in your charge to report Shelley to police?
I don't know that I did, no.
You say you don't know that you did. But what does that mean?
Well, I don't have the recollection of having done that.
Okay, so you don't recall ever having told anybody or instructed anybody to report to the police or having done it yourself, correct?
My understanding is that there was a question on the part of my canonical chancellor as to the matter to the of the computer, and my moderator of the Curia, Father Laird at the time, instructed her to take it to the police.
Are you referring to Jennifer Hasselberger?
I am.
She was urging you to report it to the police, wasn't she?
I thought she was working in our priest's work group, and the topic came up, and my understanding was that Father Laird had instructed her to take that to the police.
Archbishop, you wrote a letter to the CDF, the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, and Cardinal Leveda, specifically stating that you're concerned that your advisors have told you that you may be in violation of the law by reason of possible possession of child pornography previously possessed by Shelley, correct?
No.
Never wrote such a letter?
No. The letter was drafted by Jennifer Hasselberger, but when I read it, I did further investigation, realized that this was not correct, and the letter was never sent.
And did you look at the images?
I did. She showed me some images, yes.
She claims that those images that she brought to you and showed to you were child pornography or borderline child pornography and should have been reported to the police, correct?
No. I looked at those images and I could not tell whether they were adolescents or older.
It was a close call, wasn't it?
It was, yes.
Yeah. And so she urged you to turn that over to the law enforcement for them to make that determination, didn't she?
She may have, but it had already been turned over to the police department, and the verdict had come back that it wasn't child pornography.
You're talking about in 2004?
Well, probably, yes.
Well, what are you talking about? It's been already been turned over.
It had been given to the St. Paul Police Department, and the police department had said that it wasn't child pornography.
When Jennifer Hesselberger placed the images before you and you looked at them, correct?
Correct.
She urged you, because they were borderline, and you couldn't make the determination, and by looking at them, you couldn't make the determination, and didn't, that it should go to the police, correct?
I don't recall her at the time saying that.
What did she say?
I don't recall.
When did you view those images, Archbishop?
I don't recall the exact date. I'm trying to think, but I can't recall the exact time.
When you made the determination that you yourself couldn't tell on viewing those images whether it was adolescents or adults, did you report that to the police?
I did not.
You're a mandatory reporter, aren't you?
I am.
And you're aware as a mandatory reporter that you are required to report immediately any suspicions of child abuse, correct?
Correct.
And you're also aware that pornographic images of children is child abuse?
Correct. I was not able to determine that that was child pornography.
Why do you think we have reporting statutes? It's for the police and professionals to make that determination.
Correct, right? And they already had.
When did you learn they had already determined that these images were not illegal?
Prior to the time of her showing them to me.
Who told you the police had made that determination?
I believe it was Father McDonough.
When did he tell you that, how soon before you viewed those images?
I don't recall. It was some time before, I believe.
What does some time mean? A month, a week, a day?
I'm trying to recollect, and I don't have that answer.
Jennifer Hesselberger was telling you that she believed them to have been child abuse and, in fact, pornographic images of children, correct?
I believe that she believed that to be true.
Yes. And Kevin McDonough also had viewed those images, correct?
To the best of my recollection, I think he had.
And he took a different view, didn't he?
He did.
And what was his view expressed to you?
Well, I can't say for sure that he expressed this to me, but I know that from others that he believed that they were not child pornography.
Did McDonough tell you he had reported to the law, to the police?
He told me that that in 2004 that the computer and everything on it, the disks had been reported to the police, yes.
So you're relying on McDonough's representation to you in 2012, that it had been reported back to the police in 2004? Is that what you're telling us today?
Yes.
Did you ever learn if it actually had been reported to the police in 2004?
Well, yes.
What informs you that, in fact, the police had received a report concerning these images in 2004?
See, there was a record.
A record in the file?
Yes.
Prepared by whom?
I can't answer that.
When did you see that record that you're relying upon for that assertion?
When the whole matter was brought up about whether or not the whole file had been turned over, there was some discrepancy there. Jennifer believed that the whole file hadn't been turned over. Subsequently, when we did an investigation with the person who worked on the computer, and he indicated that everything had been encrypted into those files.
What person are you referring to?
I think it was the whoever worked for the Sutter Corporation.
There is a record that that person's report and the forensic report done by them has been withheld by your lawyer, Tom Weiser, from the police.
That's not true.
When was it turned over then by the Archdiocese?
Subsequent to that, to my seeing the images, Jennifer took that to the St. Paul Police Department, and they were given all the materials over again.
You did not instruct Jennifer to make that report, did you?
No, Father Laird did.
Did Father Laird tell you that he had told her to report?
Yes.
When was that? That Laird told you that he had instructed her to make such a report?
I think it was in 2012. I can't give you an exact date.
Did Father Laird view the images?
I can't say for sure.
Then why was Laird involved in this conversation about whether it should be reported? And how is it you now claim that it was Laird that told Hesselberger to make the report?
Well, because we had what we called a priest's working group that Father Laird started when he came aboard as the moderator of the Curia. They would meet twice a month, and they would review any misbehavior on the part of any of the priests or deacons, and they would discuss this among themselves. There would be the canonical chancellor there, the civil chancellor, the moderator, the delegate for safe environments, so that everyone had a complete picture of what was going on. And it was at one of those meetings that this question of the Shelley files came up. And it's my understanding that Father Laird indicated to Jennifer that she should take that to the police.
Did you disagree with Laird?
No.
Did you disagree with Jennifer Hesselberger on whether this should be reported to law enforcement?
No, not at the time, no.
Did you express disagreement to her at any time that she should not report this because it was not a violation of the law or for some other reason?
I suspect, thinking back on it, that I told her that it had already been submitted to the police, and that having received an answer from them on their opinion of what was on the file, that it was not necessary to take it to the police a second time.
And when you told her that, she told you, in fact, the file does not reflect that it had been reported to the police earlier, correct?
I don't believe so.
Do you recall her becoming quite animated and adamant about that?
I don't recall that, no.
Did you instruct her to leave it alone?
She asked my opinion. I told her, I cannot make a judgment here. This has already been looked at by the police. It doesn't seem to me reasonable that we would take it back to the police a second time.
And you know, have no recollection having been told by her that, in fact, the police had not examined this earlier. Only internal archdiocese officials and their consultants had reviewed it.
It was not my understanding. My understanding was it had been turned over to the police in 2004.
At that time when there was this differing view, did you make an effort to actually discern by review of the file itself whether or not such a report had ever been actually made to the police concerning Shelley?
If you're asking me if I reviewed the file with that purpose in mind, no, I did not.
What law enforcement agency do you believe it was reported to?
St. Paul Police Department.
And what date do you believe that was made?
I think you indicated in 2004.
Who at the Archdiocese made such a report, in your belief, in 2004?
It would have been either Mr. Eisenzimmer or Father McDonough.
Are you speculating, or do you have some reason to believe they actually did?
Well, they were the ones that had the responsibility, so I guess I am speculating.
So you're assuming that, aren't you?
I think with reasonable certitude.
And you base that reasonable certitude on what?
On the trust I have in the people who were telling me that they had already done it.
So because you trust them, and because you know that this information was possessed in 2004, you're assuming they made a report as required by the law in 2004. Is that correct?
Well, again, counsel, you're misstating the record.
Well, I'm asking if that's correct. If it's wrong, he can say so.
No.
Is that correct, Archbishop?
No.
No,
wait, Archbishop.
If you have an objection, make it.
I am making it. And no, don't wait. Wait, Archbishop. Counsel, again, your facts are not the record. You can't create facts, okay? You can't misstate record.
Don't give me a lecture.
Just
give me an objection.
I am giving you a lecture because you continue to do it. And it's improper. That's not what the law allows. Now, he's already told you that someone told him that. And you've asked him five times at least the same question. So if you want to ask another question in a proper way that has information in that asks him what the facts are as opposed to your facts, that's fine.
Today you can't tell me who made the report, can you?
I can tell you with reasonable certitude, but I cannot tell you for sure.
Okay. So who made the report with reasonable certitude?
I would suspect it would have been Father McDonough.
When did that person make that report with reasonable certitude?
When the matter was brought up, and apparently in 2004.
Question is when? Do you know with reasonable certitude the report was made?
No.
Okay. With reasonable certitude, to whom was that made?
To whom? I don't understand the question. To the St. Paul Police Department, you mean?
Who at the St. Paul Police Department?
I have no idea. That was before my time.
And on what do you base your answers using the term reasonable certitude that the report was made? On what do you base that?
On the trust and confidence that I have in the people who were working for me.
Have you ever seen a record that demonstrates in the file that such a report was made?
I did not see a receipt, no. I was told that there was one, and I had no reason not to believe it.
And again, who told you that?
I believe that would have been Mr. Eisenzimmer.
And when did he tell you that?
When the whole matter came up again in 2012.
And have you reviewed anything since then that demonstrates that not to have been the case?
No, I have not.
Is it fair to say then that there was a question, or let me put it this way, was there a question in 2002 on whether a report had been made? Excuse me, was there a question in 2012 as Shelley was being discussed, whether Shelley had been reported in 2004?
There was not a question. It was taken as a fact that that had already been turned over to the police, and the police had made a decision on it.
And the only fact that was taken from was what Andy Eisenzimmer told you?
I believe that's correct.
And what did he say to you?
He explained that the three files, I believe there were three files, that had been done by the forensic persons had been taken to the St. Paul Police Department.
Anything else?
No.
Did you inquire further?
I don't believe I did, but I don't have a recollection of having asked that.
When you yourself viewed those images and had the concerns as you've expressed it, Shelley was still in ministry, wasn't he?
Not at the time that I saw those images. No, he had been taken out of ministry.
What date had he been taken out of ministry?
I can't recall that.
How long after then, according to your belief, was it? Well, what was the time differential between his resignation or sabbatical and in ministry and you having viewed those images?
I think he was on sabbatical for 6 months, and then he was put on a leave of absence, and so it probably would have been about 8 months, I think. It's my best guess.
Okay. I want to go for a moment to on Joseph Gallatin, I had begun to
Counselor,
ask
I'm sorry,
you.
Let me just interrupt real quickly. Anything with respect to Shelley, starting with the Shelley questioning till now when you switch gears, is to be put under seal or noted as under seal pursuant to?
No, it's not. Shelley
yes,
has been
is.
A public matter. I have not used anything that has been turned over here. Shelley came up in the first hearing in October of this last year concerning this very matter. It's a very public matter. There's nothing that was made by way of my questions that we consider under seal. If you want to take that position, your position is noted. We're not going to discuss it further.
It is noted, and anything that involves Gallatin is the same, but we'll that is for the record, and we'll have to address that. But for the court, and I raise these issues that we would make that objection and note that to be addressed later. I'm just telling you, counsel, that it shouldn't be disclosed by you until it's resolved.
So far, any question that I've asked counsel has not been in reliance upon any information other than what has already been made public and both known to you and the public and reported. So there's nothing that has been produced in this case that has been relied upon in the questions that I've asked. Later on, we'll get to that discussion, and I'm now going to Joseph Gallatin. Isn't it correct that there was a public disclosure made by the Archdiocese on December 29, 2013, concerning Joseph Gallatin?
I believe that's true.
So let's talk about that. And that's not under seal, right, counsel? Right?
Gallatin?
Yeah.
No, I think it is, isn't it?
They're the ones that made the public disclosure that Gallatin on December 29, 2013. That's not under seal.
Well, counsel, we have the ones that are under seal. You're aware which is under seal. I'm not going to fight with you here. It's under seal, and if you violate the court order, you take your risk. But we have said that the ones that are under seal are not to be disclosed publicly until we resolve that with the court. You have to bring your motion for good cause.
Let's talk, Archbishop, about the public disclosures and representations made to the people about Gallatin on December 29, 2013. It's correct that the Archdiocese admitted that he had been engaged in inappropriate boundary violations with minors. Is that correct?
I believe so.
Who made the determination that that was not criminal sexual conduct?
I can't say.
If you can't say, why did you allow it to be described as inappropriate boundary violations when it could have been criminal sexual conduct and described as such?
There had been an investigation into this, and there had been a determination made that it was inappropriate boundary violations, that it was not criminal intent.
An investigation by whom?
I'm trying to recall, and I just can't recall right at the moment.
It was an internal investigation done by somebody in the Archdiocese. Is that what you're saying?
I can't recall in this particular instance whether that was turned over to the police or not.
Has the Gallatin file, to your knowledge, ever been turned over to the police in its entirety?
I can't say for sure.
To your knowledge, has any file of any priest accused of sexual misconduct ever been turned over to the police in its entirety, maintained by the Archdiocese?
And I don't believe so, but I can't say for sure.
And why do you guys withhold information from police?
Well, again, counsel, you have misstated. No. Can you quit trying to put words in for your sound bites?
If you don't like the question, give me a legal objection to it.
What facts do you have to state that they withheld a request that they provide, that the Archdiocese provide a file to the police?
Have you ever provided a file to the police?
Have they requested a file? Counsel, your misstatements are inappropriate and you know it.
Have you ever provided a file to the police?
We have provided to the police anything they've ever asked for.
No. Tell me this. First, answer this, yes or no. Has the Archdiocese ever turned over any file to law enforcement concerning sexual allegations and a priest?
And Archbishop, your last answer to his question, which was the same one, was just fine.
Don't instruct the witness how to answer. Did you hear the question?
If you could repeat it again, please.
Has the Archdiocese ever turned over any file to law enforcement?
I don't know.
Have you ever told any of your subordinates or officials to turn over the files in the possession of the Archdiocese to law enforcement to assist them in their investigation?
I have always maintained that whatever the police ask for, we are cooperative and we give them.
So is it your position and practice that you don't turn it over unless they ask?
That is correct.
What if you get a report from somebody other than the police that a priest has abused?
We turn that over to the police.
Yeah, but if the police don't ask, you don't turn it over, right?
No. If we had an allegation that was credible, we would turn it over to the police.
Have you ever told the police that you keep files on each of the priests, both in separate locations, some secret locations, some not so secret?
Objection, that it misstates evidence. Again, your games, counsel, ask a proper question, and then he can answer your questions.
There are no secret archives. The files are kept in a room. We had invited the St. Paul Police Department to come in and view that room just a few weeks ago. There's no intent whatsoever to withhold information from the police.
Before a few weeks ago, had you ever told law enforcement about the archival file room where Jennifer Hasselberger retrieved the Shelley materials and the Waymire materials and brought them to you?
And your question is?
Whether the Archbishop's done that?
Yes. Have you ever told police about that archival file before a few weeks ago?
I think they haven't been informed before that.
By whom?
My understanding in terms of the Shelley case, it would have been Mr. Eisenzimmer. He was the one that worked closely with the police.
In connection with Mark Wehman, W-E-H-M-A-N-N, there were some public statements made by the Archdiocese. And I quote in a release done by the Archdiocese, there were several incidents of inappropriate conduct with minors involving boundary violations. Who made the determination to use a descriptor boundary violations and that it was not criminal sexual conduct?
I believe that would have been an internal decision that had been made on that.
Who made that?
It would have been Father Dan Griffith, who is our new delegate for safe environments.
And do you know what he based that on, or if he interviewed, and or what he based such a determination?
Well, I think he knew that it wasn't a question of sexual abuse, and it was inappropriate behavior.
Was that reported to law enforcement?
I don't believe it was, no.
Was Gallatin ever reported to law enforcement?
I have no recollection of that.
So what qualifications does Dan Griffith have to determine what's a crime and what's not a crime? He's the priest, right?
He's a priest, yes. He has a law degree.
A civil law degree,
civil
right?
Civil law, yes, sir.
Yeah. So what qualifications does he have in child detection and the criminal investigation of what constitutes a crime involving children and what doesn't?
I don't know that I can answer that.
There has been some public disclosures concerning Father Keating, and he was either removed from ministry or resigned his position on or about the same day that he was sued. Is that your understanding, Archbishop?
That is my understanding.
Before you get into another one, counsel, I'm sorry, just Wehman is under seal, as is Keating, if you get into that.
This is public, and it's already out there, counsel. He's been sued.
But it's our request. It's under seal, and we'll take it up later.
What did you know about Keating and what he had been accused of and how it had been handled before Keating got sued and that suit made public?
The situation surrounding Father Keating happened before my time as Archbishop. I was aware that something was going on when I became coadjutor, because I knew a relative of the person who was involved in the case, but I didn't know, wasn't privy to the case itself, to all the details of the case.
Can you think of any priests that have not either been discussed or identified that have actually, well, let me put it this way. Can you name for me the priests that actually have been reported by the Archdiocese, either you or somebody at your direction, to law enforcement for suspicions of sexual abuse under the Mandatory Reporting Act?
You're talking about since he became Archbishop?
Yes.
The case of the one case under my tenure was the case of Curtis Wehmeyer, and we reported that immediately.
You say we. Who is we?
Well, it would have, the information came in to the civil chancellor, and the civil chancellor notified another person on our staff, Father McDonough, who was at the time the delegate for safe environment, and he also informed me that Father McDonough and this Deacon Vomastic were being sent over to tell Father Wehmeyer at the time to leave the premises and to take a leave of absence.
When did Jennifer Hesselberger first bring to your attention that she believed that Wehmeyer posed a risk of harm to the children in the Archdiocese if he was allowed to continue in ministry?
Well, again, you're assuming facts, not in evidence. If that's a statement, I don't know. If the Archbishop can answer whether that came to his attention, listening to what he asked you, that's fine.
Jennifer prepared a memo for me prior to the time that I had made him pastor of Blessed Sacrament of St. Thomas the Apostle, pointing out that 5 years previously he had...
If the question was when now. When did she bring this risk to your attention?
You're answering, and that's fine, Archbishop. Counsel, he can answer your question.
No, I asked a question of when now. I'm just trying to get the anchor for the date here, Archbishop.
And he's providing that.
I can't tell you the month and the date, but I think it was in 2008, okay, prior to my making him pastor. He was already parochial administrator of Blessed Sacrament. And we were talking...
So let's just get the when. So we're talking about the right time frame here. You're saying sometime in 2008, right?
Correct.
And you're saying that it was when Wehmeyer was at what parish?
He was parochial administrator of Blessed Sacrament in St. Paul.
And are you able to identify the month in 2008?
It was shortly after I had become Archbishop. I became Archbishop on the 2nd of May, so I believe it would have been in the month of June.
Okay. And at that time, what did you learn about Waymire's fitness as a priest to continue in ministry and the risk that may be posed by it?
The information that Jennifer brought to my attention was that Father Waymire had a same-sex attraction, that he had approached two young men in their mid-20s at a bookstore of some sort and made an advance on them. That was reported to I think that was 5 years previously, that was reported to the Chancery, and Father Waymire was sent off to a rehabilitation program, a clinic, and came back and had it would confirm the fact that he was same-sex attracted, and he was put on the monitoring program. He was to do therapy once a month and spiritual direction once a month. And I obviously didn't see him being same-sex attracted as an indication that he had any interest sexually in young children, or that he was a pedophile. I had no reason to believe that he was, and I believe that he was fit at that time to take on these two parishes.
There's some indication that in February of 2009, Rourke was his monitor. Do you have a recollection of that?
I think that would be true.
And that you signed on to a monitoring plan at that time. Do you recall that?
That I signed on? Could you explain that?
Did you sign on to monitoring plans?
For whom, please?
Each of the priests that were being monitored for sexual abuse.
That program was already in place when I became Archbishop.
But in 2009, in order for somebody to go on monitoring, didn't it require you, or as a matter of practice and protocol, to approve that?
Yes, that would have, that would be true.
And when did you place then Waymire on the monitoring program?
I believe, and I could be wrong on that, I believe that he was on the monitoring program based on that previous incident.
Yeah, I'm looking at some records, and I think that's correct. It looks like he had been on monitoring for 4 years as of 2009. Does that sound right?
It sounds right.
Okay. Did you become aware, at least in 2009 then, that he had been in monitoring for misconduct in 2004 and in 2006 for seeking out sexual encounters with 19-year-olds?
I didn't know about that second incident. I did know about the first incident, which happened, I think, in 2004 in a bookstore somewhere.
And I don't think, Counsel, your words of 18-19, I don't know that that's what the Archbishop testified to. You can ask him that. Again, you've inserted your own facts. So the Archbishop
knows that. I'm asking if he knew.
Well, how is he? Well, he's answered he knew, but you have your little soundbite. It's completely inappropriate, yet again, that you insert your facts or what you want to be the facts for whatever reasons. Let's get to what the truth is and ask the questions that the Archbishop can provide you. Try to get to the truth and not made up facts.
That little speech doesn't count on our time. And look at the documents.
You ask him, and then you can answer. He can answer. If that's what it is, then fine. But don't just say things. Ask him to answer those.
In April of 2009, I think you just said that, well, let me put it this way. In 2009, did you believe that Waymire was fit to continue in ministry without informing any of the parishioners and the public that he was on the monitoring program?
that time, we didn't, I don't believe that we had informed the trustees that he was on the monitoring program.
And you didn't inform anybody other than those in the official position of the Archdiocese? So that would be your chancellors, the vicar general, yourself, and the monitors, correct?
At the time, I don't believe so. If that were to happen today, we would disclose to the trustees.
We're talking about 2009 now, okay? Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
Correct.
In April of 2009, to recall receiving information from Hasselberger about concerns about a change in Waymire's status from being the business administrator to being the pastor.
Well, that would have happened, I think, in 2008, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, but she raised concern in 2009 to you, is my question. Do you remember, you know, you made that decision in 2008?
I thought I had.
Okay.
Could have been 2009.
Okay. Let's assume then that you made the decision in 2008. Do you recall Hasselberger bringing the concern to you about why that was done?
She brought the concern to me that he, about the incident that I told you about in the bookstore. And that he was same-sex attracted.
And she also raised with you the concerns about the St. Luke's findings that had been made and in the file, correct?
She may have. I don't recall that.
You recall that he had been diagnosed with having sexual compulsion or sexual addiction and unable to control his sexuality?
No, I don't remember that at all.
Did you read the St. Luke's report?
I believe I did, yes.
When?
At that time, before I made him pastor.
When you made him pastor and changed his status from business administrator to pastor, did you know that he was a risk of harm?
I did not know. I would not have made him pastor if I had known.
He proved to be, didn't he?
Unfortunately.
Did Father Laird warn you against making him pastor?
He did.
And he told you that there are questions about his fitness to be in ministry, much less to be a pastor, didn't he?
He thought he was somewhat unstable.
And in April, was that a yes?
That's what he told me. He said he had an unstable personality. But Father Laird clearly didn't like Father Waymire, and there was, a bias there.
So you thought it was a personality conflict between Laird and Waymire?
I thought to a certain extent, yes.
And so you didn't think about the fact that Laird was speaking for the safety of the potential children where he was serving as pastor?
Well, there was no indication that he had interest in sexually abusing children. There was no indication at all.
When you read the St. Luke's report and received the other information you've described at the time you made him pastor and continued in ministry, did you tell anybody at the parish what you knew about his history as reported in St. Luke's, as raised by Father Laird, or as raised by Jennifer Hasselberger?
At the time, I believed that was the responsibility of Father McDonough. I found out subsequently that he did not inform the trustees, but normally in those situations at that time, we would have informed the trustees of the parish.
So when did you learn that McDonough had not done what?
I think it was in the last week of September.
Of what year?
Of 2013.
Did anyone ever tell you, or did you ever learn from review of the file, that Curtis Waymire had been restricted from working with youth in 2004?
No.
Have you ever heard that before I made that assertion today?
I have not.
Did you learn that Curtis Waymire had gotten a DUI in 2009?
I did.
How?
It was reported to us. It was after I had made him pastor. And it was reported to us, I think, through Father McDonough.
And did you also learn that as a part of that arrest relating to the DUI, he had been trying to solicit some young people to party with him?
I don't recall that as part of the DUI.
What do you recall as a part of the DUI and what you were told or learned?
I learned that he was on a camping trip and that he went into a kind of a 7-Eleven type place, and they noticed that he was unstable in his walk, and someone called the police, and they came and stopped him from driving and gave him the citation.
Were you aware that when he was arrested for the DUI, that he called Joe Keppers as his criminal lawyer?
I was not aware of that. I knew that he was friendly with the Keppers, so it doesn't surprise me.
Were you aware that at the time of that, he was still on monitoring?
I was aware of that, yes.
Did you ever see the report or get informed by any of your any of your officials that the report says that he was trying to pick up teenagers to go back to the campground to party?
No, sir.
Having heard that, is that the first time you've heard that?
I believe so, yes. I didn't know that.
Does that alarm you?
It does.
And would it have alarmed you if you had been told that back then?
Certainly would have, yes.
You did know he was on monitoring. You did know
no,
he
I
had.
No, I did know he was on monitoring.
I said you, oh, did, you know, did know that. You did know about the other things. At that time, after the DWI, did you call Curtis Waymire in and say, I need to get to the bottom of this and ask him if he had been engaging in inappropriate sexual contact of any kind with anybody?
During that time period, I called him in four times from reports that I had gotten in the parish about his anger management or mismanagement, I would say. But I didn't have the knowledge at that time to question him on his and any sexual activity.
Well, you knew about the St. Louis report. He was a sexual addict. You knew that.
But he hadn't had any. But that had been 5 years before, and he had been in therapy, and he had been in spiritual direction. And the St. Luke's report indicated that he was fit to go back into ministry.
Well, if you had reason to call him in four different times to ask him about certain things not pertaining to his sexuality, why didn't you ask him about his sexual conduct or possible misconduct? didn't you want to know?
Well, those were not things that had been reported to me. There was nothing of a sexual nature that had been reported to me except for the St. Luke's remarks and the report of the 2004 incident.
But sometimes the way you get information, Archbishop, is to ask. And why didn't you ask him?
Because there was no reason to.
The St. Luke's report gave you reason, didn't it?
It did, but that had already been a matter of at least a year, and that I had received that report. No, that would have been in 2004. I'm getting confused here. I had to deal with the situation of what was current in his administration, and that happened to be the question of his getting along with staff, his anger mismanagement. Those were the topics that were on the table.
Serba was urging you to not continue him in ministry because of his sexual issues, wasn't he?
I don't believe that.
Well, then what was Serba concerned about, as expressed to you? It was the sexual issues, wasn't it?
No, Serba never expressed any sexual concerns to me.
What was the basis for him being concerned about his unfitness to be and continue in ministry, if not sexual?
Are you talking about Serba?
Laird, I mean, excuse me.
Okay. He never mentioned anything to me about his whole sexual nature. His concern primarily, as I recall it, was that he said he didn't think he had a stable personality.
Did you ever tell anybody to get the 2009 police report that reflects what I just told you about him and the teenagers?
I did not. I wasn't. I was aware of the arrest, but I wasn't aware of the other incident that you just alluded to.
Did you tell anyone to get the 2009 report?
No, I don't believe so.
You knew there was a police report?
Sure. Would have known there was a police report.
When is the first time you asked that a list of abusers be compiled, both accused or credibly accused?
When was the first time I asked that? I believe it would have been in October when we were making our plans to do disclosure.
You're talking about October of
2013.
And who did you ask to do that?
It would have been the members of the staff, the canonical chancellor, the civil chancellor, and the delegate for safe environment.
And specifically, who are you talking about here?
I'm talking about Father Dan Griffith. I'm talking about Joe Kippers. I would talk about Susan Mulheron.
Susan whom?
Mulheron.
She's a secretary to the Vicar General?
No.
No,
She's the chancellor for canonical affairs.
Okay. And when was such a list first compiled for your eyes?
In October 2013.
And how many priests or deacons were on it?
My recollection is that there were 36 on the original list.
And then how many, that was the original list of the credibly accused, as has been described, you're talking about?
Correct.
And then were there any added to that? Because that list had been compiled originally in 2004. We're now in 2009. Any new names?
2013. There were subsequently another nine that were added to the list.
Any of those now on the credibly accused, publicly disclosed?
They're all publicly disclosed, and they're all out of ministry.
All nine?
Yes. Out of ministry and without faculties to function as a priest.
Did you ever see any lists of priests accused of sexual abuse of minors before October of 2013?
No.
Did you ever ask anybody to compile one or prepare one or give you one?
I did not.
As the Archbishop, isn't your first goal and primary to make sure first the children's souls are safe in the Archdiocese?
Certainly is. It's my primary goal to make sure that children are safe.
Well, then why wouldn't you making sure you get all the information possible from all those under your charge about?
Well, I had.
Who could pose a risk of harm to those children?
As I indicated before, I had that conversation with Father McDonough and others when I first became coadjutor archbishop. I knew that they were under the monitoring system, and I felt that they were not putting children at risk.
But that was back in 2008. We're now in 2013. Why hadn't you done more before?
Well, I think we have done more. I mean, we've done the Virtus program, as I indicated. We've done background checks on everyone. We've had seminars and programs for our clergy and for our staff. So it isn't as if we weren't working on this. And as I've said before, that our number one priority is to make sure the children are safe.
When you got the compilation in 2013 in October, was that made publicly known?
Yes.
To all the people?
That was publicly disclosed, yes.
Okay. And did you turn any of the files pertaining to any of those and or all of those accused offenders over to law enforcement agencies?
To my knowledge, we did not. They were all out of ministry.
Yeah, but they may have been guilty of crimes, right?
That could be, and so I believe some of them would have already been turned over to the police.
But you don't know which ones, do you?
I don't.
Because you made a conscious choice to not turn them all over, correct?
Well, objection, counsel. Again, you've made a misstatement of facts for the purposes of your own needs here. If anyone has ever asked, you can ask, did anyone ever ask you that you've not turned over a file? You can respond, Archbishop.
Archbishop, the question was, you made the conscious choice to not turn all the files over to law enforcement, correct?
I don't believe it was a conscious decision. I think we were trying to disclose to the public, for the safety of children, those who had abused.
But there's a difference between identifying names and turning over files to law enforcement, correct?
Well, objection, it misstates evidence. I'm not sure that the Archbishop has a foundation.
You can answer the question.
Difference for what?
There's a difference between disclosing names to the public and turning over files concerning those names to law enforcement, correct?
There would be a difference, yes.
Okay, let's talk about those two things. You're saying you turned over the names to the public, right?
Yes.
Okay. How many of those files, of those names of offenders that were made public, were turned over by the Archdiocese to law enforcement?
I can't answer that. Sorry.
Can you answer that any were?
No.
Is it correct to say that no file had ever been turned over after a determination had been made that a priest was credibly accused to law enforcement until and unless law enforcement asked?
Objective foundation. Are you talking about while he's been the Archbishop?
Yes.
I don't recall.
So is it fair to say that your answer is that you have no recollection of ever having voluntarily said, look, we just looked at this file and made a determination internally that this is a credible allegation. Let's just turn it over to law enforcement. But whether it's Chisago County, Washington County, Ramsey County, or Hennepin County, let's just do that voluntarily without a request. As far as you can tell or remember, you never made that decision.
No,
correct?
I think that there were cases that were turned over to the police in December, I believe, with Father Gallatin.
Okay, now we're talking about December of
2013. Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else?
There were three, but I can't think of the other two.
Did you turn those files over to law enforcement, to the police?
I believe we did.
To whom?
I think it was the St. Paul Police Department.
Had they requested, or did you do that on your own initiative?
I don't recall.
So, do you recall ever, on your own initiative, ever ordering any files to be turned over without request by law enforcement?
I don't have that recollection, I'm sorry.
Have you reported any of the offenders to the CDF?
I believe we have, yes.
Who?
Waymire, certainly, and I believe Montero. I believe there was another priest by the name of Busman. So there have been files turned over to the congregation.
Waymire, Busman, and whom else?
Montero, I think. Although that may not have been because he wasn't our priest. So I'm not sure about that one.
When was Waymire?
Shortly after he was charged with the crime.
When was Busman?
before my arrival as Archbishop.
And Montero, you're not sure about, but no, it was not done by you.
It probably wasn't because he wasn't our priest. He belonged to another diocese.
Under the SST issued in 2001, you're required to report to the CDF, are you not?
Yes.
And required in your quinquennial report to also disclose any allegations of sexual abuse.
Yes.
Have you done that in the quinquennial report?
Yes.
And so who did you disclose in the quinquennial report?
I don't recall right off the top of my head. The quinquennial report would have been I want to say 2010, but I'm not sure about that. And so I just don't have that recollection right now.
Did you report Shelley to the CDF?
I don't recall.
Isn't that something you would recall if you had?
It should be. I agree. I would be speculating, though, to say that I did.
Do you have any recollection of any others having been reported by you or your offices to the CDF under the SST requirements?
All that we were required to would have been handled by the canonical chancellor.
And you're the reporter and the one that signs off on that report, however, are you not?
I am.
Father Wojda, Joseph Wojda.
Counsel, is it a decent time for a break? Sure. If you want to finish this, that's fine. But
it's fine.
It's been going an hour and a half.
Sure.
Thank you.
We're going off the record at 12:15 p.m.
This is video number 3 in the deposition of Archbishop John Nienstedt, taken on April 2nd, 2014. Time now is 1:04 p.m.
Archbishop, before the break, I had begun to ask about Joseph Wojda. And did you become aware that they had Roma conducted a canonical trial, a penal trial of him, and findings had been made?
I recollect that, yes.
Did you become aware that the instruction was to remove him from the clerical state?
I don't recall that particular part of it.
Did you become aware that at some point in time the instruction from Rome was reinvestigated by your office or at your instruction by Kevin McDonough? Did you ever instruct that to be done?
I did not.
So that if it was done, it was your predecessor?
Must have been, yes.
Are you aware that McDonough did reinvestigate Wojda after the Rome instruction, and made the recommendation that Wojda be suspended for 10 years from ministry. Are you familiar with that?
I'm not familiar with that at all.
At this point in time, what are your plans pertaining to Joseph Wojda? Is he going to be allowed to continue in ministry, or is he going to be reinstated?
He's, my understanding is he's not to be functioning in ministry at all.
Did you become aware that there was some controversy around McDonough's findings that contradicted those of Rome?
That must have been before my time.
Okay.
Could I make a correction? I was told by my counsel that I was confused about the 2004 investigation of the Shelley computer. Apparently, we turned that over to this Mr. Sutter, who was a retired police officer. That's why I thought he had been turned over to the police. And then that was turned over to the forensic, so I got that mixed up. I thought it went to the forensic first and then to the police.
Well, Sutter, S-U-T-T-E-R, S-E-T-T-E-R, is an investigator hired by the Archdiocese. You're aware of that?
Yes.
Yeah.
But apparently a retired officer.
Yeah.
And so I got that confused.
Okay. So
I apologize for that.
So as we speak, then, you have no information that any official law enforcement agency acting as a law enforcement agency ever received a report in 2004?
No.
Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
I apologize for that.
Were you relying on that same mistaken belief when you were making decisions about Shelley in 2012, or is that just a correction for today?
That's just a correction for today.
Okay.
Thank you.
Archbishop, you have made a number of statements to the public and the parishioners that the primary goal is to care for those abused by priests, and made promises to the people that that is one of your goals, is it not?
It is, yes.
You did make the decision, did you not, to permit the taxation of costs against Jim Keenan, who had litigated against the Archdiocese, and have a judgment entered against him for $64,000 for having brought that case. Do you consider that to be consistent with a promise to care for the victims?
I'm not familiar with that case.
It was John Doe 76C, and it was the one that went to the Supreme Court.
And what year
your watch?
What year was that?
2010, I think.
It's not registering with me. I'm sorry.
Are you aware that the statute of limitations had... the Supreme Court had determined the statute of limitations had expired, and therefore his claim and others like it could not be brought? Did you learn that at some point?
No, I don't believe I did.
So you have no knowledge of the taxation of the costs against him?
No.
Okay. In the case of Curtis Wehmeyer, when did you first learn definitively that he had been accused of, or suspicions arose that minors were involved?
The day that he was arrested.
What day do you have that date?
If you remember, Archbishop, don't guess it. If you don't know,
I don't remember. I believe it was a Friday, though. Do you remember that?
Some records show that his arrest was June 22nd. Is it correct? So, what did you learn on that date, and from whom?
I learned from, I believe it was Mr. Eisenzimmer, that Father McDonough had been informed of the allegation, and that he and Deacon Vomostic were going over to Blessed Sacrament to tell Father Waymeyer at the time that he was being removed from his assignment.
And you had received no information before that time and that date that Waymeyer had been suspected of involvement with minors?
No, I had not.
Had you received information that Waymeyer had been known to have been taking minors on camping trips?
No, I only became aware of that at the first week in October of 2013.
Did you ever, did you become aware that one of the officials had called the mother of one of the children who had been taken on camping trips to discuss that relationship?
I learned about that in October of 2013.
What did you learn about that? Who had made that call?
It was Father, at the time, Father Serba, Father Paul Serba, who was had just been appointed the Vicar General and moderated the Curia.
So he was empowered to handle this on your behalf, correct?
He was.
Okay. And so, when you learned on October 13th, then, that minors were involved, definitively, October 13th.
No, it's October 2013.
Oh, excuse me, October 2013. What did you do about that?
I don't understand the question.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I want to get my dates correct. I think you had told me earlier that the date you first learned that minors were involved was the date that he was arrested. And some records show that he was arrested on the 22nd. Does that sound right?
That's when I first learned about the allegation, yes.
And what action, if any, did you take responsive to having learned that?
That day, I agreed with the decision when Mr. Eisenzimmer told me that they were, that Father McDonough and Deacon Vanostic wanted to go over there. I said yes, do it right away.
And that was before it had been reported to the police, though, wasn't it?
I think it was reported at the same time. I think they were simultaneous.
Why would you want Father McDonough and Deacon Vanostic to go to Curtis Waymeyer before it had been reported to the police?
Well, in hindsight, that was a mistake. But I think we wanted to act immediately on the information that we had.
And you're aware that Father McDonough and Deacon Vomistek met with Waymeyer that morning at the parish?
I think it was morning or afternoon. It was.
And you're aware that they retrieved the gun and got a computer from Waymeyer, correct?
Objection. I'm not sure that that's facts and evidence, counsel, again. I got something to show him that, ask him.
Are you aware?
I heard about the gun. I didn't know about the computer.
Is that the first you've heard of having Waymeyer having turned a computer over to McDonough?
To my recollection, right now, yes.
So you never looked at the computer of Waymire?
No.
And that, if McDonough took possession of it, that where is that computer?
I don't know, sir. This is the first I've heard of that, so.
I'm going to show you exhibit. Who else did you talk to besides Eisenzimmer about this then that day?
That day, I don't believe I spoke to anyone else about this.
And once you learned it, why didn't you report it?
My presumption was that the one that would normally do the reporting is the civil chancellor. And so my understanding was that he was going to report it and had already reported it, had called the police.
Do you believe the mandatory reporting statute that applies to you permits the delegation of your responsibility to somebody else? Don't you?
I have the authority, but I believe that as long as that things are done correctly, that's what's important.
The statute provides an obligation, not an authority, correct?
I believe so.
No objection. Okay. It's a legal conclusion. The statute speaks for itself.
What did Eisenzimmer tell you about when the Archdiocese had first gotten a report? When you talked to him?
He told me that morning.
That morning of the 22nd?
Yes.
All right, let me show you Exhibit 18. And before I do, let me just ask you, Archbishop, what did you find out specifically about who had made the report then about Waymire to law enforcement and when?
Could you repeat the question?
What did you find out about who had reported and when they made that report?
I'm sorry, to the police or... To the Archdiocese.
I think I learned later that day, is my recollection, that the police had been called and that Father McDonough and Deacon Vomastic had gone over to bless the sacrament.
Who was the first in the Archdiocese then to have received the information that minors were involved?
That would have been Father John Paul Erickson.
And what were you told about that?
I was told that he was informed of that, that the person in question had told him that there had been an incident of incest in the family.
Well, let's go back. I'm talking about the abuse of the child, and by Waymire. Okay. So, is it your testimony that was departed by Father Erickson?
Father Erickson was the first one, I believe, to have been told of the abuse. Because the mother in question had discovered some incest in the family. And she had subsequently, in talking to her children about that, discovered the involvement of Father Waymire. And she went back and told Father John Paul Erickson again. But it was in the context of spiritual direction, so it was a privileged context. So he had to call her and get her to report this to us outside of that context and to the police.
Who told you that?
Father John Paul Erickson.
When did he tell you that?
I believe that was, excuse me, I misspoke myself. I think Andy Eisenzimmer told me that the same day of the...
On June 22nd?
Yes.
Were you told that the report had been made in the context of the confessional?
I hadn't been told that it was in the context of confession. What I had been told is it was in the context of spiritual direction.
And you also knew that Erickson was a mandatory reporter?
Yes.
And that what he had been told would require a report?
Correct.
Have you talked to Father Erickson to get some more clarity about what he was actually told and the circumstances of it since?
I have not, no.
Why not?
I thought he did what he should have done, and the end result was what needed to be done to get Father Wehmeyer out of to get him reported to the police and take him out of ministry.
What should he have done?
Well, in hindsight, I suppose he should have taken this to the police himself once he had clarified the context of which the communication had taken place.
And do you have any knowledge that he did?
I do not have.
And your knowledge to this date as to who actually made a report to the police then is limited to, who is that to?
To Mr. Eisenzimmer.
The same day that you learned?
I believe so, yes.
Same day that McDonough had, and von Mistek had gone to visit Wehmeyer at the parish?
That is correct.
I'm going to refer you to Exhibit 18. And you have it before you, Archbishop, and this is entitled a decree. And is typewritten with your name at the bottom, correct?
Correct.
And it states, on June 18th, 2012, the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis received a complaint that Reverend Curtis Wehmeyer, a priest of this archdiocese, supplied alcohol and sexually explicit images to a minor and fondled or attempted to fondle the minor's genitals, period. Correct?
Yes, correct.
It then goes on to state, I have concluded that this constitutes information which, quote, at least seems to be true, unquote. Correct?
Correct.
So this reflects that on June 18th, the information was received, does it not?
It does, but it's incorrect.
And who prepared this?
Jennifer Hasselberger.
And what makes you say that, or believe that, assert that it's incorrect?
Because I have since learned that the information didn't come to us officially until the morning of the 22nd.
Well, mandatory reporting doesn't make a distinction between official and unofficial, so what do you mean by official?
Again, objection to the legal conclusion in the start of your
What do you mean
question.
By official?
What I mean by official is The context in which it was first revealed was a context that was privileged. And so what I refer to as privilege is the part that's not privileged.
Okay. It goes on to say the third paragraph, since my other duties prevent me from conducting this investigation personally, I hereby appoint Reverend Peter Laird, Vicar General, to act as investigator in this matter, correct? You did that?
Correct.
And then you also, at the fourth paragraph, instructed that in conducting his investigation, Father Laird is to take care that such investigation does nothing to harm Father Wehmeyer's name or to violate his rights to protect his privacy, correct?
Correct.
Is there anything in this decree that talks about protecting the victim or their family?
The decree, to my understanding, is a canonical document that pertains particularly to a priest who has acted out badly.
Did you sign the decree before Vomestek and McDonough went to the parish?
No, I did not.
When did you sign it?
Well, I couldn't have signed it on the 20th. So the dates here are wrong.
Well, that's where we're going to go right now. It says, given on June 20th, 2012, and then it's signed by you.
Correct.
So you're now asserting that that date is also incorrect.
Correct.
And you're asserting that's incorrect on what basis?
On the basis of subsequently, I found out that I learned this on the 22nd, so I couldn't have signed it on the 20th.
This is a pretty serious matter when you issue a decree for an internal investigation, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And that is your signature, so you did sign it. You're just
disputing
the dates, is that right?
Right.
So you did order internal investigation. Did you order this internal investigation before or after the report to the police was made?
My best recollection, it was after.
You're not sure about that, are you?
Well, this whole period is a rather confusing one.
You're not sure about any of these dates, are you, really?
Objection, well, that's argumentative counsel. He's testified to what he can testify to.
Well, you did... Are you? You're not sure about the dates, are you?
I'm sure that these dates are wrong.
And what document is there that establishes, other than this document, this decree, exactly when you learned that of the abuse of the minor?
I'll object, first of all, the decree, Exhibit 18, does not establish that, as the Archbishop said.
Well, first,
go ahead as to whatever.
The question is when did you first, what document is there, if there is one, that can establish the date you learned it?
There would not be a document. I'm giving my testimony of what I recall.
The conversation with Isaac Zimmer, was that in person or by telephone?
It was in person.
At the Chancery?
At the Chancery, yes.
In his office or yours?
My office. He came down to my office.
Anybody else present?
No.
Did you make any notes of that conversation?
I did not.
Has there been any record made by him of that conversation?
I don't know that.
Has there been made any record by anybody that you know of, in or out of the Archdiocese, that establishes that the report was actually received by you on the 22nd versus Exhibit 18, which seems to demonstrate the 18th?
I don't know of any other document, no.
It's unfortunate. There is evidence that on the 19th, there was, or 20th, there was a meeting called by Greta Sawyer, and she was employed to interview this mom and child. Were you aware of that?
I was, yes.
You ordered that as a part of the investigation, did you not? And empowered Laird to do it?
I don't believe that was the right order.
Well, he decreed an investigation, and Laird was given the authority to do it.
That's
and he
correct.
Was given the authority to give to her to interview these people, right?
That I don't remember. My understanding is that the mother had been advised to go to see Greta to reveal this allegation.
Right, been advised by either Erickson or Laird, correct?
I think it was Father Erickson.
Right.
Yes.
And so she did, and she brought the child at the request of Father Erickson, correct?
That I don't know.
And you're aware that an interview was conducted of the child at that time?
I wasn't aware of that, no.
Is that news to you?
That is news to me. My understanding was that the mother went, and I had, until now I had not heard that she brought the child with her.
The child was interviewed, according to the records that we have, at one of the Chancery offices on the 20th by Greta Sawyer, and tape recorded. Is that news to you?
It is.
And that, it could have been the 19th or the 20th. In any case, that would be before you claim a report was even made to the police, correct?
Well, my understanding of the sequence of things all revolves around this privileged context, and my understanding was that Father Erickson had suggested, because he didn't feel he could break the confidentiality of the conversation, that she should go to see Greta Sawyer.
Well, the interview done by Greta Sawyer was done at your offices, at the Hayden Center.
At the Hayden Center, yes.
Yes. And that was not a confessional, secret kind of thing. That was done at the request of Greta Sawyer and Father Laird, correct?
That I don't know.
Well, weren't you overseeing this?
I was overseeing it. My understanding is that it was Father Erickson that had advised the woman to go to see Greta Sawyer and to reveal this event and the allegation therein.
Did Greta Sawyer tell you about the meeting before it happened?
No, she did not.
Did Laird tell you that they were going to meet before it happened?
No, he did
not. Did Erickson?
No, he did not.
So you didn't know it was going to be?
I did not know.
On the 21st of June, there's an indication of a meeting in the morning between Hesselberger, Laird, and Eisenzimmer. Are you aware of that?
Not, no.
That's news to you?
It is.
Have you looked at any of the documentation pertaining to this matter at all?
No, I didn't know it existed.
At 9:42, there was an indication that a litigation was placed, and there was an instruction given by Andy Eisenzimmer on that day to not destroy any files or evidence. Are you aware of that?
I'm not, no.
Had there been some destruction of files and evidence before this time?
No.
Of any cases that you're aware of?
No.
That you know of?
No, I do not.
Why would he give such an instruction if that hadn't been a practice in play before?
I have no idea. It was not our practice.
After you then first met with Eisenzimmer and learned what you claimed to have learned, what was the next thing you did, or what did you do responsive to the information you received?
I instructed him to do what he had told me we should do as the next steps, which was to inform the law and the police, and then to inform Father Wehmeyer of the accusation.
And it's your belief you prepared the decree then after that time?
That's my recollection, yes. I didn't prepare it. Jennifer Hasselberger prepared it.
But you signed it?
I did sign it, yes.
And she was authorized to prepare it as you what?
Correct.
Can't the letter.
Correct.
Did you read it?
I read it, but I wasn't paying attention to the dates per se. I was looking at the content of the statement.
In the first paragraph, you are reciting when you received the information, and you use both a quote and an I, don't you?
Yes.
You read that, didn't you?
I did.
Okay. When's the next time you received any information from any source pertaining to either the internal investigation or Waymire status?
Well, I had asked, as the document indicates, I asked for a regular report from Father Laird, and so that would have been given to me, generally speaking, at our weekly meetings, which is on Tuesday mornings.
Was that after the arrest?
Yes, it would have been after the arrest.
So is it correct to say that the only information you had and the only source of that information before the arrest of Waymire was that told you by Andy Eisenzimmer and nothing else? Is that
correct.
What you're saying?
Correct.
And you've told us everything that Andy Eisenzimmer told you?
Correct.
And
what I recall, yes.
Talking about that day, right?
Pertaining to that subject, yes. Do you have any discussions of having meetings with your top officials at that time, Hesselberger, Laird, Eisenzimmer, about whether it either should be reported or should have been reported sooner?
I don't recall any discussions on that at that time. I know that there were discussions of that subsequently. When it was reported in the newspaper, but at that time I don't recall any discussion of that.
What discussions are you talking about subsequently? What was said by and by whom?
There was a sequence of discussions that took place, I believe, in early October of 2013, about what the dates were and how the sequence fell out. And there was a great deal of confusion about that. And of course, Jennifer had already left our employee at that point, so we weren't able to ask her about the confusion of the dates.
Who have you asked about it to try to clear it?
We talked about it in terms of my staff at the time. It would have been Mr. Kippers and Susan Mulheron, and I believe our communications director, that we were trying to figure out the sequence of how that all happened.
And you're talking about Jim Accurso?
He was not involved in the...
Who was the communication director then?
Sarah Mealy.
So really your discussions are more about communications management and crisis management than trying to get to the bottom of really what happened.
Objection.
No,
that's
no,
argumentative and misstates facts.
I would not agree to that. No.
Well, then why had the communications person involved?
Because she was involved in all of our discussions.
But that's for purposes of public relations. I'm interested in what you did about protecting the children and making sure you adhered to the law. Who Why'd you bring a communications person into that conversation?
Well, because this was subsequent. This was in October 2013, as I'm saying. But when I first discussed it after the event had taken place, we acted immediately to inform the police and to make sure that he was taken off of the premises so that he couldn't be a threat to the children.
You have made, and your office has made, a number of statements that you have acted immediately to inform the police concerning Waymire. And do you make those statements to try to assure the people that they can trust what you say about child safety and your reporting of it?
We say that because that's our policy. And as we would say in any other situation, we would quote our policy. This is the way we act, and we let people know that.
Jennifer Hesselberger has been very critical of you in the way you handled Waymire. Has she not?
I don't know. I haven't talked to her about it.
Well, you've seen the NPR reports where she has.
I've heard her quoted, but I haven't talked to her directly about this.
And she has reported very publicly that you did not report when you learned that Waymire had abused.
Well, she's inaccurate on that. She's not correct.
And as a canon lawyer, she's your record keeper, isn't she?
She should be.
And you have no records today, nor are you aware of any that contradict the assertions she has about what you told her and when it was reported, correct?
I have my memory, and my memory doesn't correspond to what you're telling me she has said.
I think we need to take a break here, so let's take a short break.
We're going off the record at 1:44 p.m.
Let's go off the video record for a moment.
What is the actual time, videographer, of what we've got on a videotape deposition?
I have 3 hours, 35 minutes, and 52 seconds.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. We are back on the record at 2:03 p.m.
Archbishop, because you made a correction at the start of the last section concerning Shelley, I'm going to go back and try to get your testimony concerning some of the things that need to be asked, given that correction, that weren't asked because of your testimony given for it. I'm going to show you an exhibit 38. And it is a memo from you, excuse me, from Jennifer Hesselberger to you, correct?
Correct.
And pertaining to Shelley in February of 2012.
Correct.
At that time, at the bottom of the second paragraph, it reflects Shelley was without supervision. Is that your understanding?
Archbishop, just read the document, the entire document,
no.
So you have it in context.
No, you're not.
Well, counsel, you can't ask out of context.
Go off the record. Let me...
Well, no, isn't that going off the record? He has a right to read the deposition.
No, we're not going to have him reading documents, taking the time on the record. That's intended to delay the process.
You want to ask a question about a document that's in front of the Archbishop, and you want to be unfair and not let him read to see what the context is? Is that your position?
No, we'll take a break, let him read it.
Well, why would you take a break? When do you ever do that in a deposition? This is a deposition. Ask your questions.
We don't have people that are trying to delay the depositions like you.
I hardly am trying to delay the deposition. If questions were asked properly, it would have been much quicker.
Mr. Hawes, you're an officer of the court. You know better than this.
I am.
We'll take it up with the judge, but I'll tell you right now, I'm gonna read a portion from this, then ask you a question, Archbishop. In this memorandum, to you, she states the reason this was not given more attention in 2008 only became clear recently. For while there is reference to the misconduct in Father Shelley's green personnel file, the detailed information relating to the misconduct, including the investigator's report, was of 48 restricted files that were archived, meaning moved to the basement without reference to it being placed in the personnel files in early months of 2008. Do you remember discussing that with her at that time?
I don't at this moment. I don't recall discussing that with her.
She goes on to state, and I'll ask you, I have attached a list of files that were removed to the archives, although we have not been able to locate all the files on the list. Were there files moved to the archives, Archbishop?
We have two archive rooms, and the files of active priests are in one, files of priests who have left and priests who are dead would be in another room.
And in the same memo at the second page, there's a recitation of various things known about Shelley. My question to you is, as is stated in the memo to you, she says, in 2004, while Shelley was assigned to St. Jude, Father Shelley's...
Counsel, can you just tell him where you're reading from?
At the top. Shelley's personal computer, one of three, was mistakenly donated to the parishioner during the parish garage sale. Do you know what happened to the three computers?
I only see here one of three.
Yeah, but I'm talking about there were three computers. Do you know what happened to those three computers?
I know that the one computer that they referred to was ultimately turned in by the person who received the donation. He came to the Archdiocese about it. I don't know what happened to the other two computers.
There's also reference to the Archdiocese ordering an investigation and a computer analysis to be done of the machine. Did you see that yourself?
I did not.
You were told there were images on there by the experts that did the analysis that there was questionable or borderline child pornography, were you not?
I did read the context, and I think it said they were borderline, but they didn't think it was child pornography.
But there were questions about that, were there not?
I think there were questions for Jennifer.
And you had questions about that?
I did.
And aren't questions the same as suspicions enough to justify a report to the police at that time?
I sincerely thought that what we were doing with this outside investigation, that the person, the forensic person, and the retired policeman had the wherewithal to make that decision.
You say outside investigation. The fact of the matter is this is a
an internal investigation.
Yeah. That is
with an outside company.
An outside company hired by the Archdiocese.
Correct.
To find out for them what's on it, right?
Right.
Okay. And all of this investigation was done and handled by those retained and those in your office, correct? Nobody outside the Archdiocese.
You're referring to the 2004 time frame here?
I'm referring to the two. Yes.
Well, what I meant by outside was that they weren't people that worked directly for us on our staff.
Father Shelley's still in ministry, isn't he?
Father is not in ministry. He's on a leave of absence.
Okay, excuse me. He took a sabbatical.
He took a sabbatical, and then he was placed on leave of absence.
Okay. The point that this memo was sent to you, and you read it, Shelley was in ministry, was he not?
He was.
And he was continued in ministry, was he not, by you?
I don't have those dates. This is 2012. He would have been out of ministry.
It was June 2012 that he took a sabbatical.
I don't know where you're getting that date.
Archbishop Hesselberger refers also at the bottom paragraph that she's attaching a copy of a September 23rd, 2004 letter of referral to the SLI. That would be St. Luke's Institute, correct?
Correct.
You had seen that report, had you not?
I can't recall at this moment whether I did. I'm confused by this.
You're referring to the letter or the report?
The report, the St. Luke's Institute report. Had you ever seen that?
I don't believe I did. If it came in September of 2004, I wouldn't have been present on the
The records seem to reflect that they actually got the report and sent him there before they got the computer evaluated or completed.
I don't know if those are facts or not, but
well,
if you know.
I would have to look more carefully at this.
Okay, well, let's just look at a sentence. It says, at the last paragraph, she says, Archbishop, I'm attaching the copy of our September 23rd, 2004 letter of referral to SLI, as well as their report to this memo. Correct?
Correct.
That means you received it. Correct?
That somebody would have received it. Yes. Yes.
Well, this is to you.
Yes.
So you're not disputing you received it.
No.
Correct?
No.
That is correct?
That's correct.
Okay. The last paragraph, and she writes to you, Father Shelley has not been assessed by SLI since the computer was determined to have images that were borderline illegal. Did you do anything responsive to that information, Archbishop?
I don't recall.
At the next page, the last sentence, she writes to you, you will recall that this has not been without problems, including
Where are you reading, please?
The next page.
Yes.
Last sentence of the first paragraph.
Okay.
She writes, you will recall that this has not been without problems, including the fact that Father Shelley had an 18-year-old male living in the rectory of St. John the Baptist in 2009. Did you know that, Archbishop, before having received this?
I don't believe I knew it before receiving this.
So when you got this information, did you think about it?
I do believe that it was looked into by somebody on the staff, and I think it was my delegate for clergy, who would have been Father Tiffany.
Okay, and did he give you a report or take any action?
I think it was past the time that the young man was living there.
But was Shelley interviewed by you or any of your delegates?
I believe by my delegate. I believe by my delegate.
And was that recorded or reported to police?
I believe it should have been. I don't know. I can't say definitely it was, but it should have been reported.
Do you have any knowledge that it was?
No, I don't.
The next paragraph goes on to state that the second sentence, beginning, the paragraph starts with however.
Yes.
And the second, I'll read it. It says, however, now that you have access to the information that was recently recovered, including DVDs of the material that was found on the computer, I think there is a great risk of associated with us reassigning Father Shelley. I read that correctly?
You did.
You did reassign him, didn't you?
I believe, and I don't believe I did reassign him at that point. He was already in Hugo.
Actually, you left him there for 6 months, didn't you? In the parish you was.
I believe I did, yes.
Without notifying anybody of this information that you had received from her, correct?
That would be correct, but I don't know that her information was correct here. I'm just looking at this again. It's been a long time since I've seen it.
Well, let me ask you another question. Under that same paragraph, enumerated number one, she states, I'll read and then ask a question, collecting all the personal computers, laptops that Father Shelley is using at this time and sending them for similar analysis. This is a recommendation action. Mm-hmm. It states, if the SLI report is correct and Father Shelley has an ongoing problem with compulsive sexual behavior in his internet pornography use, it is very likely that this use will have continued. And since Father Shelley's never received treatment to address this, did that alarm you, or do you remember that alarming you at the time?
I believe that would have alarmed me at the time, yes.
What did you do about it?
I can't remember what I did about it.
Did you alert any of the parishioners, or the public, or the police of what you were alarmed about and the information you're receiving in this memo that concerns you?
I honestly can't say right now what I did or didn't do.
At the last paragraph, you do state, it is stated by her, I shared this information with Father Laird last July. Do you have any memory of having taken any action to report Shelley to law enforcement, to alert the parishioners or the public about the risk now discerned concerning Shelley's danger to children or possible possession of child pornography?
Objection, that misstates the facts, the evidence, the document you just read, counsel. There's not a word in there that says that there's a danger to children. So you've misstated the record, again, inserting your own facts. If you ask it another way, it would be a proper question.
Did you take any action responsive to the information contained in this memo?
I believe that there was a question of the ongoing nature of the images that were on that computer. And I believe I was waiting for a final analysis of that in order to make some kind of reaction.
And so it is correct that 4 months later, Shelley was allowed to resign from his parish, claim to the parishioners that he was taking a sabbatical, correct? With your permission.
I'd have to look at the record.
You have a memory of that?
I don't have a memory of that. I know that he did ask for a sabbatical, and he was granted a sabbatical. And then I put him on leave after other information came to the fore.
And did you or anybody under your direction ever alert the police or the public of what you knew as contained in this memo about Shelley?
Not to my knowledge.
And I'm going to refer you to Exhibit 45. Before I do, do you remember a dispute between Jennifer Hasselberger and Kevin McDonough about whether these images on this computer were illegal and child porn and thus a form of sexual abuse?
I do remember there was an argument, yes.
Tell us about that argument, what you heard and what you did responsive to it.
Well, Jennifer maintained that the images were those of child pornography, and Father McDonough said they were not. And we had at the time, the investigation that was done with the retired policeman indicating that these were borderline. And so there was a dispute, obviously, about the nature of these images.
And Kevin McDonough took the position that 60% of the images are created by law enforcement, and because he had not been caught, he had not been guilty, and he made that case to you, didn't he?
I don't recall that at all, no.
He also claimed that they may have been pop-up images and innocently then on that computer. Do you remember that?
Subsequent to this, yes, I remember that.
Jennifer Hasselberger disputed that vigorously, did she not?
I believe she did.
And she went to the length to even copy some of those images and put them on your desk, didn't she?
Those were the same images, I believe, that you referred to before.
How many images?
I think there were only three that I recall.
And she told you that she had showed those to McDonough, and he ordered her to put them back in the archive, didn't she?
I believe she did, yes.
And she was upset about that?
I believe she was, yes.
And she wanted you to take action, didn't she?
I believe she did, yes.
And you chose not to, didn't you?
Well, I didn't think they were child pornography.
She also urged you to report to law enforcement. Those images were, and what the Archdiocese knew and included in Shelley's file, including the earlier stuff, correct?
I don't recall that.
Okay, I'll show you Exhibit 45.
Yes.
And I'll direct your attention to 45, which is dated February 8th, 2013. It's to you from her. Fifth paragraph down, she writes, "I would also like to reiterate that I think all of this information should be turned over to law enforcement for their determination in hopes of avoiding prosecution for you and your staff by offering an affirmative defense." She wrote that to you, didn't she?
She did.
And then she states, "Finally, I am attaching a memo written by Father McDonough when he made a similar assessment of Father Waymire, his conclusion which Father Laird supported." In other words, she's saying, don't make the same mistake here that you made with Waymire. Is that the way you read this?
Objection. It's assuming facts, not in evidence. It's not what the memo says.
As you recall, is that the way you read it?
No.
You didn't turn this over because you were worried that you were in possession and you could be prosecuted.
That's not true. I didn't turn it over because I didn't think it was child pornography.
So what training do you have in the area of what is and isn't child pornography?
Not very much.
Well, what training at all?
None.
Okay.
Which?
Okay. Let me ask you this, Archbishop. You've now testified and publicly declared that you have identified those that you believe credibly accused and that you have files pertaining to them. Don't you think it's past time to turn it over to law enforcement? And if so, will you do that now?
Objection. That calls for a legal conclusion and something that the Archbishop doesn't have going to do at this point in time.
Well, I'm going to ask you, will you turn the files over to the law enforcement agencies?
As I mentioned before in this testimony, we've had a thorough review of the files by the Kinsale, and with they're still in the process of doing that, and I'm waiting for that results of that to be able to do exactly what you're suggesting.
But Kinsale is hired by you, aren't they?
Correct.
Okay, just like the Clergy Review Board is appointed by you, correct?
Correct.
Just like Setter was hired by the former Archbishop, correct?
Correct.
And just like the forensic investigator was hired. So the question I put to you, and maybe it's a request, why not just privately turn the files over of those priests to law enforcement to let the professionals review them instead of trying to do this yourself?
Same objections.
Why not?
My answer would be we are prepared to do what we have to do when the Kinsale file review has been done.
Don't you realize how risky it is and the danger that's posed by keeping all these things within your control and those you hire and keeping it under the internal processes that you have instead of turning it over to the professionals who are trained in law enforcement investigation?
And I'll object again, counsel. You're trying to make sound bites. There's no evidence that the Archdiocese has not cooperated with any law enforcement officials, with any person that's been accused.
That's not a legal objection.
That is a legal objection, counsel, because you continue to try to create your own clips. And that's not.
No, we're trying to protect kids
question.
Here. We're trying to protect kids, counsel.
Well, then
give
ask
me a legal
the questions
objection.
About it. Ask the questions about it.
And I'm asking the Archbishop and giving you a chance to give the law enforcement people to know what your office knows by turning those files over to them privately and letting them investigate it.
Okay,
why don't you do that?
We will, as I indicated to you, once we have the file review done.
Why
we don't
wait? Kids are at
counsel,
risk.
We're
I
done.
They are.
We're
what
done.
Do you mean you're done? We're not done with this. We're not done with this deposition.
Let's go on. What time does the? I'm sorry.
You're declaring the time is up.
Let's take a break and find out what the time is. Okay. Just take a break right now. From the video, and we'll find out how much time you've been on the video.
We're going off the record at 2:34.